We left off last session, and most of the party had had an interesting adventure in town, but we'd lost track of one person, one character, who had vanished in the middle of the night. He had been doing some research, found a paper of interest, went back to his room, purportedly to rest, but then apparently Prime saw as he left in the middle of the night, without a word to anyone. Ptolemaeus, what did you do?
I would like to have gone to kind of familiar old haunts that I knew of where my father likes to go to.
To where he would go, or back to your old neighborhood, kind of, so I get a...
Kind of around the old neighborhood, not to where he was, particularly.
Okay. There is a small shop not too far from the home you grew up in. It's a quiet little place. It's a bit of a bookshop, but people treat it more like a library. In that the proprietor, he doesn't sell anything, but he trades. And depending on the worth of the documents you bring in, you might get a fair or an equitable trade, but he tries to be reasonable, always looking for new things. And so your father liked to go there. He liked to find things to bring home to you, to challenge you with. And as you got older and began to make more rational and logical arguments with what seemed to be logic beyond your age, he made more and more frequent trips as he tried to find things that would challenge you. So, what a wonderful place to start. You make your way into the neighborhood, and you notice, even though it's rather early in the morning, the light is on.
I approach, but very cautiously. I don't want to alert anybody around the neighborhood or inside. But I will approach the shop, knowing what it is.
Right. As you get close to the door, you're startled as a group of children about 10 years of age come charging out from an alley on the side. Roughhousing in the streets. I mean, after all, there is a festival going on. But for you, this has a special, special import. Please, roll me a d20.
That's an 11.
As you stand there and these children run past and kind of brush against you, you distinctly hear one of them say, "Hey, let's go see what's in the well." This, of course, shakes you a bit. And you have a sudden flashback of a memory. Tell me, what was it like in the bottom of that well?
Aside from the obvious darkness and the water, a lot of water. I never really know how slippery rocks could get. It's always the feeling of sort of almost making purchase, getting a grip, and then not getting a grip. That futility is probably the one thing that kind of hits me at this moment the most.
You suddenly feel strong, firm, but yet somewhat gentle grip on your hand, pulling you forward, pulling you up out of the well, and then suddenly you're back in the street, and you realize there's an old woman pulling your arm. Come on, come inside. What's, are you okay?
I'm fine. I'll follow along.
She walks immediately to the place that was the object of your attention. And after a few minutes, you realize many years have gone by. This is Sophronia, the proprietor.
I'm sorry. This seems to be your shop.
Well, it's more of a center for the community, a place to share knowledge. Not so much a shop.
But
although if there's something you'd like to buy, I'm sure we could come to some sort of an agreement. Do you have any books? Any papers?
I do. Nothing that I would rather part with at the moment, but you say it's a center of the community, and I would say if it held so much knowledge, then the people that frequent it, they are philosophers themselves.
Well, many are. I've had many people cross through these doors. Some philosophers, some seeking, well, religious enlightenment. But then those who are just searching for the answers of day to day. What are you seeking?
Or what of the ones that seek just simple quandaries? Quandaries that could potentially just challenge young minds, or maybe just minds of those that just like to understand more of the world.
She looks at you for a moment, and you feel a tingle as her hand runs down your arm a bit and then releases it.
I kind of reel back.
Let's not play games. You're looking for someone in particular. What do you need?
How is he?
He's not been here since his son passed away.
Then it's been a while, but he's still in the area.
He comes and goes. He spent many years at the Forge of Pyrphoros, studying with the druids of the mountains, trying to learn, well, trying to recapture something lost.
An unfortunate lesson in futility, then.
Some might say that, but he's quite revered. He's well known, and he's actually produced, well, 2 or 3 anvil rods himself. One is actually considered quite the treasure. If you get a chance, you might talk to the council members and Meletis especially, and see if maybe you can meet Meletis. Prime, his anvil rod. He was brought back by Nyctos.
I'm sorry, you mentioned Prime.
Yes. Let's go inside and make a nice cup of tea.
I...
You misunderstand. It wasn't a request. Come inside. Let's have some tea.
Sure. I have a little time. I'll follow her.
You are escorted inside, and tea is set up, and there are several papers lying all around. I have to ask, did you bring the page that you found when doing your research back at Alita's home?
I don't think I actually took anything, did I?
You had a paper, and I believe you did pilfer it so that you would have the symbol that was in the corner. Your intent was to take it back, of course, but you were going to study it some more, you'd said.
Yes, I did. I did bring it to the room. Well, it's still in the room. I didn't bring it along or anything. I just wanted to read it a little bit and then bring it back. There are mysteries, especially ones that, well, seems to have had connections to others.
What is your interest in Nyctos the philosopher?
I have a vested interest in understanding how people cope with loss.
And so you're wishing to speak to him about this?
No, just to understand from an outside point of view.
She stirs her tea, and you see that, oddly, most people stir clockwise. She's stirring it counterclockwise. You know, one of the big debates in all of philosophy is, what is truth? Is a half-truth a lie? How far does that half-truth go? What percentage must be a lie for it to no longer be true and a lie? Why do you want to speak to Nyctos, the philosopher?
I don't. Not anymore. I just wish to know his well-being. And that is not a lie. I do have a vested interest in those coping loss. That is also not a lie. Whether or not my intent needs to be known, perhaps that's where the half-truth comes in.
Well, I don't presently know where he's located, but I can attempt to find out for you if you'd like. Check back in a couple of days.
I should still be here. If something happens, though, and I'm not here, I would implore you to send that information to Meletis, if possible.
And under what name should I send it? The seeker of information of Nyctos in sorrow and grief, but doesn't want to speak to him? Seems a bit long.
The parchment will fit, right?
Fine.
No, I I'll take a knife and just cut off a little bit a lock of my hair and just hand it to her. Just send it with this.
She takes it. Okay.
You know that'll sour the leaves, right? Or at least that's what the old wives' tale says.
That's okay. I don't actually drink it anyway. And she sets it down to the side. It's more for the guests.
So it was... I see. I should be off, probably. I don't think I, whatever page you mentioned should probably stop being misplaced soon.
Well, if you need help finding any information on it, bring it with you. We'll see what we can do.
Thank you.
Of course. Good luck, Locke. And she kind of hangs the hair and sets it on
like
a piece of paper.
I like that very much. And I'll walk out.
You step outside.
I'm already upset.
You step outside and you had no idea how much time had passed. It seemed like you were only talking a few minutes in there. But the sun's coming up. It's daylight.
Thinking that I might be in trouble because a certain something is very perceptive of things, I'm going to immediately go back to the Elitist abode.
All right. As you start making your way back, the streets just become packed. People waking up. The drinking begins early. The festival is on. There's partying everywhere. And every step you take, someone tries to distract you. Someone places a glass in your hand. Someone grabs you to dance with you.
I'll just try to deflect it as much as possible. If someone's dancing, I'll just kind of like shimmy away. And then if someone gives me a glass, I'll just immediately promptly hand it over to the person next to me the other way. And just continue on. Very one-track mind getting back into the Elitist house.
All right. Do me a favor. Make a perception check.
Okay. Oh, that's not bad. Let's see. What's my perception? That's a dirty 20.
That is excellent. I couldn't have asked for better. You're walking along for a bit, and again, someone grabs your hand and pulls you over, and it's a satyr. And at first, you get the feeling it's Tycheros from the size and everything, but then you realize, no, this definitely is not Tycheros. Tycheros does not have a long gray beard.
No.
So pretty flitty clear it's not. And as you try to excuse yourself and you turn back, you bump into someone and you catch just a flash of them under their hood, but something seemed odd about it, but you can't quite place it. They're wearing a long black cloak with a hood over their eyes. And they were looking up at the sky coming away from the harbor, which is odd considering how close you are to it. Most people like to see the sunrise, but he was looking away from the harbor. And when you bumped into him, you attempt your apology, excuse me,
yeah,
and just almost brushed you aside, ignoring you. And that's when you noticed the palest white hand you've ever seen. And the disappears into the crowd away from you.
I would assume even though they disappear into the crowd mostly, there's not that many people wearing black, right? So,
oh no, it's party time. There are festive colors everywhere. Those who are dressed, there's a lot.
So well, dressed, right? Yeah. So is it more surprising that I cannot see this black cloak anymore because of that?
I would say that it is unusual to you. You are definitely surprised that you could not follow this person through the crowd.
I'll just give a couple of parting glances. Okay. And going back, just continuing.
As you're walking, you begin to hear this loud noise coming from ahead of you and behind, every direction but the harbor. It's a screeching kind of a noise, and it gets louder, and the sky begins to darken, and it looks as though clouds are rolling in from outside of the city and just beginning to cover it. And the noise gets louder, and you begin to realize its distinctive calls blending together of thousands of crows.
Oh, I've seen this horror movie again. I'm gonna run to the Elita's house. I'm not gonna be in any phone booths. Definitely just keep running.
As you're running, you notice that ahead of you, because you're on the far side and you're approaching the center of town at this point, they begin to kind of come together, and they're landing at what appears to be the council chambers. And they're just going, and they're landing all around and just covering the tops of all buildings. Any flat surface they seem to be landing on. They don't seem to be bothering anyone specifically, but they are making a horrendous noise. And while the people are still partying, obviously there's some trepidation about this. So many people are stopping and, you know, taking bigger swigs of their drink and watching what's going on.
Yeah, because loud noises get louder when you're more drunk, though. But I will actually, with this, understand that I probably need more help if there was going to be any problems. So I will actively start looking for the rest of the group.
Okay. You walk around a bit, and it's just a daze of where you're at. Some of the familiar landmarks that you would be able to tell from the buildings, you can't see now because they're literally covered in crows. And suddenly, everything goes quiet around you. And then screams begin to erupt from over towards the council chamber. A horrendous noise of fear and angst. You hear some shouting in the distance. You can't quite make out what's being said. And then the crows begin to attack.
I knew it. Definitely seen this horror movie before. Where do they start attacking? Is it all centered from the council building?
It appears to be starting from that direction and just flowing outwards. Almost like a wave, the birds go from being docile and annoyingly loud to attacking, swooping, swarming in, tearing at people.
Yeah, I'm definitely going back then. I'm definitely going back to where the group could be.
All right. It's going to take a while for you to weave, protect yourself as you head back that way. But eventually, it seems like hours, you've made your way back. You are bedraggled, your clothes are torn, you have scrape marks and cuts. And as you clear and make your way back straight towards the house, you see your compatriots standing outside. They seem to be a little worse for wear themselves.
We didn't cause any of this, right? I wasn't gone, and then something happened and we caused something else.
Quick question. This is post-birds, right?
Yes.
So Agrios has run directly back to the house, so he's not here. Cool. Have we recovered our clothes yet?
Yes.
Okay. Ariana's putting her clothes
back. We'll put you at that point where everybody was kind of getting back together, so.
10-4. Ptolemaeus, where have you been?
bathhouses. Anyways, what happened? But yes, obviously. Look at me. Look at you. What happened to all of you?
Well, you see. Apparently there was a big axe problem. Everyone blamed it on Mogus. We didn't think it was Mogus. Also, if he comes back, be gentle with Agrios. He's having a bit of a crisis. But, yes, we thought this might be Mogus. We went to the Temple of Mogus to try and solve it. That didn't work. Tycheros and I went on a recon mission, met the nastiest man I have ever met in this entire city, and now we're here.
Perhaps it would be best for us to discuss this back at the house?
Inside. Yes, inside. Away from public ears.
No, just away from the crows. Really.
Ah.
Most of those have started to clear off by this point, but yeah, it's...
I believe this sacrifice... Well, I don't know. Hard to say what exactly disbanded them, but...
It wasn't the thaumaturgists? I thought it was the fireballs. Personally, I dispersed fireballs.
Probably the fireballs.
Yes, you... Ptolemaeus, you missed quite a bit. Let's catch you up.
Okay, sure. Yeah. I'll just follow them inside.
Once you step inside, Prime is... Oh, so you're back again. I guess you found him.
Indeed I have been, well, found.
Okay, so I'm not good at this. I know we've just been hired as researchers. That went through Ptolemaeus. You weren't there, but we kind of just, I think, assigned for you, so...
Yeah, I mean, it was, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I, for one, am not good at this, so are we looking into crows? Are we looking into what Agrio said that may or may not have been from Mogus? Moira, or that's not your name.
It's
the name on the screen. I looked over.
I apologize.
No, it's my bad. I should remember everybody's names. Vara, good lord. I even have it in my notes. It says, Vara said a smart thing. Vara definitely seems to be on
the
right
track. Diary. Today, Dear Diary. Vara said a smart thing.
Smart thing. Many smart things at that. Vara seems to have a lot of theories that seem to be in the right working order. So where do we think we should? And creatures are continuing to speak to Tycheros, I believe.
Yes, yeah. there was definitely a crow that talked to Tycheros on our recon trip.
I think that I can suddenly talk to animals. It's just happening to me.
You know, if it was any of us, I'm not surprised it's you. You're so friendly, it makes sense that the animals would like you to.
Specifically birds, though, and birds involved in the things that are... So the first time it was crows, and then it was vultures. So we have a couple working theories.
Was it not harpies first?
Vultures, harpies.
Same thing.
It was a harpy. It was a harpy first.
Yes. Bird-esque.
Fair.
Bird light.
So should we be looking at a bird heavy? They're quite large.
Yes, so maybe let's look into birds. Adrastos, it seems like you didn't have the most enlightening experience with the person at the Temple of Vara.
The experience that I had of that gentleman is that his opinion of himself is much higher than I think he has deserved.
Yes, well, I had a thought, Ptolemaeus, that we saw the handprint once more, so we believe whatever is going on, once again, still trying to interfere with the games and posing as different gods.
Did you see the handprint, though?
What did we see?
Someone was picked up from the ground in front of the
council
chamber
members.
And crushed.
Yes. Was it one of the council members, or was it one of their aides?
I think it was a council member.
Was it? That's player memory failing. Can we confirm
it was
who it was?
It was a council member. Yeah. Yes, it was.
I can't remember which one.
Yeah, no, you're correct. The one that we didn't know a name of, I think.
Yeah.
Yep.
Unfortunate. Okay, so what else have I missed besides the hand?
I will be the council's chosen champion in the games, or at least one of them.
Oh, that's... Congratulations.
Yes. Thank you. I'm very excited.
Where's Agrios?
Well, Agrios had a trying time today. He's not exactly sure based on various information you've received and words spoken through him as Oracle. He's still questioning whether or not he is the Oracle. But he did make a sacrifice in the temple of Mogus. Last I saw him, I believe he was
coming back here, no?
Yes, we all needed to grab our clothes. Half of us were still... We went to the baths, and that's when the crows attacked, so some of us were rather nude for the fight.
Well, that's Ariana's got surprising
Agrios's horse armor, over his shoulder.
It's surprising that we didn't... You know, there are a lot of bathhouses, so we probably didn't coincide.
We went to one of the council. I think Ariana, I saw, was trying to scheme some information out of one of the aides.
Scheme? Me? Never.
So, I personally, after what you've told, I've just noticed, found a very interesting occurrence, and I think since we're all here, and there's nobody else around, right? It's just us right now.
Prime is kind of hovering around the area. He's not directly there, but he's close enough he could probably hear anything.
Okay. With Prime too, I'll just be like, and Prime, I know you're not gonna, there's not gonna be any malice that comes out of you. Tycheros, why do you know that village's name?
She just she stares just off into the distance for a little bit. And she looks you directly in the eyes and says, well, it's a common enough name. That was my husband's name. But it's very common. It just gave me a start, is all.
Prime, how common is that name?
Oh. Well, it's not uncommon, but, I mean, if you go around that region, it would be a tribal name. But to be named and have a village named after you, I mean, you must be somewhat special. And normally it would be something like Tavi the Wonderful or Tavi the Magnanimous.
He was wonderful. He was so wonderful.
If there was...
And Prime's just going to look at you.
I'm beginning to wonder whether or not this has anything to do with that particular region. There are so many connections with the village that disappeared. Connections with the beasts. Talking to you specifically, I'm sure there were others in the city that could talk to beasts, but not in the way that the beasts would talk to them. That's one of the threads that we could go on at this point.
But first, we've got to find out who's trying to stop the games. We have so many research duties. Oh my word, I have research outfits for us. And she just quickly pulls out of her little pack, like a bunch of these brightly colored ribbons. She's got a red one, she's got some gold, and she's got some silver. And she looks at the red one and she goes, this one's for Agrios. I'll put it aside for him. I have big plans for his battle braid. And she pulls the silver ones out and she hands one to you, Ptoly. And she hands one to you, Vara, silver ribbons. You can wear them wherever you like because you like the stars. I think silver is the color for you. And she hands the gold ones to Ariana and one to Adrastos. And she looks at you two and she says, "You two are so golden. Gold reminds me of both of you." And she hands them to you. So now we have researcher outfits. So what are we going to do?
Adrastos
immediately puts his on.
I was gonna say, yeah, Ariana like
just
ties
full
hers
naked
around her
into the suit.
I'm gonna step up and look and go, "Oh, I saw similar ribbons to that in the marketplace. These must have been quite expensive."
They were prime, but I have some resources.
If they're related, ten resources.
And resources.
if they're related to work here, I'm sure that you can ask to be reimbursed from Master Meletis.
That's an excellent idea. And for that excellent idea, you can have this gold one as well.
So it's just a ribbon?
Thank you.
It's just a little ribbon.
Okay, yeah. So what Adrastos is going to do is he's going to look at his hands and he's going to take the red ribbon off of his left hand and he's going to tuck it and he's going to put the gold ribbon in its place. And tie it down.
Tycheros is delighted. She just kind of dances around you a little bit with like ridiculous excitement.
I love it. Inspiration for that, Adrastos.
Yeah.
He looks at Tycheros and smiles and he says, "You know, this is the hand I carry my shield with, and I think it fits." And so he just smiles.
My heart.
I'm still like holding on to the ribbon. I'll just be like, "Well, okay, if that's the case, we should probably try to figure out, well, first of all, console Agrios so we could have us all united. And I still can't shake the feeling that all of this is connected."
I think you're
right. We'll figure it out. We'll figure it
out,
though.
Games first, and then the village, because I really would like to go investigate, too. You're totally right, Ptoly. But can we do the games first?
I'll go bring this up to Agrios and see if he's ready to come down.
Sounds like a plan.
Sure.
Much reading to be done. I wanted to look more into Ifara. I feel like we can... we already know that... Well, in theory, Mogus has spoken through Agrios and mentioned that he is against the impersonation of the gods. But from what's been occurring, I this is one thing I brought up, Ptoly, is I believe that Vara could potentially be of use to us. I know none of us are necessarily one of the followers, but... they care for civilization and the fall of civilization and the loss of such structures such as the temple and different things like that. It can't be something that she's happy about, so perhaps we could get her to our side. I think as many gods as we could possibly bring to this matter would be wonderful. And Vara will just kind of busy herself with Prime and go looking around, grabbing as many notebooks and things. And if there's any information on Olantan, the original, and gods and temples that were in Olantan, like the old gods.
At this time, I'll just kind of like nod and understand. I was like, "That all sounds wonderful. I do have one more thing to say. Prime, the page that was missing that's in my room, could I keep it for a little bit longer?"
Well, you will. How long?
At least until we can solve this village thing.
I recommend then, allow me to make a copy of it. I will do as close as I can.
There are markings that I would want, just to be sure.
Of course. I am quite talented at artistry.
I trust that.
So he will go find a blank piece of parchment and wait for you to give him that, and he will make a copy of it.
Yeah. Then in that case, I'll just be like, okay, Ariana, you don't go talk to Agrios, and we have all of this set up this way. I'm going to go back to my room. I have to deal with that as well, and we'll reconvene here, and I still have to figure out how to put this on. And I'll just kind of look at the ribbon as I walk to the room. Just still kind of just out holding the
Tycheros, you have been granted an inspiration from one of the viewers.
Ooh.
For your excellent clothing modification choices.
Oh, that's very special.
Well deserved.
So thank you. I believe it's LJ Crudge, however you would pronounce that. Sorry if I'm mispronouncing it.
Yay! What? Gifts.
So about this time, the front door opens and Elitis enters. He looks a bit frazzled and very harried and hurried as he rushes in. Prime, stop what you're doing. Come here. Prime, I need you to just listen and do what you're told here, please. Counselor Lafia has been killed. The council have voted, and we need you to dispatch a message to the philosopher, the one who lived in the Far Eastern Quadrant, Nyctos, I believe is his name. He has been named pro tem to the council until an election can be held. Of course, I will see to it.
What were those names again, sorry?
Lufia is the counselor, that's Luphea, is the council person who was squished. Yes. And there is a well-known philosopher who has been elected pro tem to the council, and that his name is Nyctos.
For no reason at all, could I roll a deception check to keep a straight face? Just no.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
I think that would be
no
wonderful.
Reason. Yeah. Oh man. Man, even with it, with all that, huh? That is only a 17.
Oh, that's pretty good though. That's pretty good. So that's with everything good. Else going on, it's unless anybody here is going to check and say, hey, do we notice anything odd about Ptolemaeus? You're
may I roll an insight?
I'm holding the ribbon in front of my face.
Please roll in. Please feel free to roll an insight.
No. Very low.
So you keep it quite well. You may clear your throat or something, but it's just kind of a, you know. So Prime begins and I will have to determine his location. The last place we knew of, he was researching in the southern part of the peninsula. He was looking into some things that were happening around Citessa and down south of there. Great. Excellent. In fact, no, we've got to get him back, so no, we can't. He turns. What are your plans?
The games.
Are those that are disrupting or seems to be planning on disrupting the games?
I see. Well, that's probably the best plan. This is a matter of some urgency, though. I'll have to find someone else. I was going to see if you could carry the message, but I'll find someone else to do that.
When are the games?
Your mission is more important. The actual procession from Meletis to Akros is happening like later today.
Okay, that's what I thought.
So
perfect.
within a 3-day journey, walking by foot.
Ooh.
Yeah. So
are we traveling
right
with
edge.
The procession? Or are we traveling separately? Did we decide that?
Not yet. I don't think.
You didn't do this, so Alidas is going to look over and go, Well, that is the question. What is your plan?
I presume if Adrastos is meant to be the champion of the council, it would be odd for us to not travel with it.
Yes, that, if we're trying to not draw attention, yes.
Probably easiest that way.
Yeah. If I mean, you could... Oh, go ahead. Sorry, Ptolemy.
Oh, if that's the case, then we should probably head out as soon as possible. We should get Agrios and get everything situated for ourselves. Unfortunately, you will have to find another... Just deliver the message.
Agrios, you're welcome to join at any time. So I sent you a message, okay. But I'm not sure you saw it.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. That's I just kind of assumed he was sulking in his room or something.
Yeah. Let me go grab Agrios. I'll head off to go grab him.
We have to leave with the procession later today. I have about 40 chapters to get through. Hold on.
So Prime is going to he's in the middle of writing something. He's going to stop and turn and Miss Vara, I have some information for you. I'll see what we can do about getting the information for you. And Tycheros, I have information for you as well, but I will try to have it for you before you go. But obviously, I must finish these things first.
Of course. Thank you.
And he immediately goes back to writing.
I'm going to go back to my room as well.
Alita says you're heading out. Prime will see to getting anything that you need for the journey. Food. Will you be walking? Do you need a cart?
I'll be walking. I don't want to speak for the rest of them, though.
I can walk.
Walking's good.
Is that what's standard? Is walking? Or do people use
it
cars?
Can be either. We could arrange a cart if needed. But...
I think walking's fine. If anyone gets tired, I mean, we have Agrios, and I can always shift into a horse myself.
Being ball and told as a mount.
I remember. Yeah, right?
Yeah.
I'll go so with knock,
that? Knock. Oh, come in.
I brought your stuff.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Not a problem. We're discussing our plans on leaving. Are you coming and discussing?
When you come in, he is clearly moping.
Oh.
Like, you know, horse-wise, he's like lying down. If there's like a windowsill or a table or something, he'll have his arms up on it.
Yes, it's fine.
Is it, though?
Why wouldn't it be?
Well, you're kind of having a crisis.
Oh, well, you know, I just thought for a long time that I was the Oracle of Mogis and just Mogis, and now it seems as though any god or entity who cares to has been using my mouth as they please, like a crew of low-paid sailors in a brothel where I'm the only one working.
Inspiration.
Or you are that talented that everyone is choosing you.
Talented at what?
Maybe you're clearly strong enough to handle the voices of gods. Not everyone can do that. I am a paladin of my god, and he's never spoke through me.
Or I'm just a convenient puppet.
Well, perhaps. Regardless, you have proven yourself strong in battle. You've proven yourself on numerous occasions, clearly entirely worthy of Mogus in your dedication. So perhaps this is someone that is strong enough to impersonate the gods themselves. It wouldn't be surprising if they could take you over as well.
You really think I've proven myself worthy in battle?
Entirely.
At this point, Adrastos is going to walk up, honestly, completely oblivious to what he just heard. He's going to go, Agrios, do you think you could punch me without trying to kill me? Come on. Just leave your weapons here. I want you to hit me as hard as you can. I need to practice blocking.
What's the point? All right.
Wait! Tycheros runs in. He can't do this, Adrastos, till I fix the braid. That's the problem.
Oh, of course.
And she gets the ribbon and holds it out to you, Agrios. Time for the battle braid? Just quickly, before you go. Come on.
Oh, I don't know. Oh, all right.
And she just launches into it really quick to, like, not hold up the little battle that's just about to happen. She does a little braid and she plaits the red ribbon. It's red for blood, Agrios. I thought you'd like it.
I do like blood.
There you go.
No.
Ariana's going to check Adrastos' wraps.
All right. You come here, Adrastos.
And he winds back and gives him a punch at him.
And Adrastos tries to just do, like, the chamber block.
All right. Agrios, give me an attack roll, please.
All right. Let's do it. That is... So for an unarmed strike, that's a dirty 20.
Great, you hit me.
With 4 bludgeoning damage.
Okay.
As he just socks him in the jaw.
So, well done. You've certainly earned that red ribbon.
Oh, I can't help it. I do feel better.
Ah.
You know, Agrios, Oracle of Mogus or not, in my region of Arescos, a red ribbon was a sign of a strong warrior. Normally we'd wear them on our hands. Wearing one in your hair does not make you any weaker. And I will just clap him on the shoulder. You'd make a good sun claw. And then I'll just walk out.
Agrios definitely looks a bit happier. He's smiling more.
Ariana's standing like in the corner, just like,
He starts proudly dressing himself back into his armor.
All right.
Could you help me reach back there? It's always a pain.
Of course. So lock everything back up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, okay. I've never done this on a creature that could speak to me. Is this good or is that too tight?
It's a bit snug.
You know, I always thought that. Everybody always told me, no, it has to be totally tight. Otherwise, it'll slip. But, like, no. I don't think it needs to be.
Horses are weird, though. Aren't they strange? They've just got this weird long head coming out where the rest of the torso should be.
I can understand that being very strange. Although, I'm probably very strange in that I should have horse coming out of where my torso starts.
Somehow, it's a bit less strange when it's the lower part that's different. I mean, can you imagine just a pair of legs and then there's a head on the waist?
Ariana thinks for just a second and then breaks down laughing.
It's bizarre.
That is the most bizarre. Oh,
horses. You're... Creepy.
You're funnier than you think you are, Agrios. She's gonna start walking out.
He trots out after.
Krista is killed by that image because holy shit, just a head on a set of legs.
It's hilarious.
Oh goodness. All right. Are there any preparations that you would like to do individually before you hit the road with the festival? Yes, Adrastos.
I'm going to go outside kind of on my own. And for the first time, really, like, I might even check in with Ariadne and say, no, really, don't follow me this time. And, like, go and, like, just go off on my own and just do a little prep ritual. Like, you know, getting ready for the games, kind of like I take off all of my armor. I take the wraps off of my hands, crack my knuckles, say a little ancestor prayer over the wraps, and then very like ritualistically rewrap my hands, gold on the left, red on the right.
All right. Very good.
Ariana will do that like cross-armed mom in the doorframe lean when he walks away.
I love it. Tycheros.
I will go looking for Adrastos, but assuming he's already gone, I don't find him. So what I'd like to do is sneak into his room and just leave this little necklace that I've pilfered. It's like, it's a really rough necklace and it's got like just an M on it. I've just kind of taken it from the markets, but the M made me think of his friend who died. And I know he's very sad about that. So I want to just leave the necklace on his bed so he doesn't even know where it came from.
All right. Very good. And since nobody's watching, I think you could do that totally unseen by anyone. Well, Emmaus.
I'm only going to do two things. Number one is I will slip the one page. Since Prime is busy, I'm going to take the page and I'm going to slip it into all of the other scrolls that I have and take it with me. And then the other thing is I kind of sit there and stare at a wall for a little bit and then looking at the ribbon and then finally taking the ribbon and on the brooch that I have that connects my clamis, I'm just going to wrap it behind it. So then there's like, it's like a silver ribbon flare out of the brooch. And then I kind of huff a little bit and walk out.
It's nice where you've got it attached and your hair flows down beside it. Every once in a while, the pattern that shifts in your hair, the stars go by and it's a matching color for it. So you get this interesting streak as it reflects the color of the stars in your hair.
Is there like some sort of a mirror in the room?
Oh, absolutely.
After doing that, I'll just be like, I'll look at it a little bit and just like, well, I guess we should be matching or something like that. And I'll just walk out.
Excellent. Vara, as you are getting everything ready, Prime is going to deliver to you a book. And this is a duplicate. We have two copies of it. So I think it would be fine if you took it with you. And it is a book on legends and mythos and stories of the gods.
Huh.
And it specifically dates back to old stories. And there's a subtitle on it that says Mythic Odysseys of Theros.
Cool. That's
the book you take with you.
Awesome. Great. And then I assume I've gotten through enough of... I was reading on... The main thing I was also researching was the Nameless. So would it be safe to say I've gotten through the bulk of that reading and have that info now?
Yes. Yeah.
Perfect. Cool. And I will hand that to him in exchange. And...
All right. Excellent.
Thank you. I think I've gotten what I need from this.
Very good. I see two fingers up. I'm going to give Ariana a moment here first.
Okay. Ariana will, as standing at the front door looking grumpy at Adrastos, but genuinely trusts him to do what he needs to do. So we'll leave him be. But we'll sort of pop over and pop her head into the library. And Vara?
Yes.
You are... I don't do well with words and reading. Never have. Always better at lifting. Carrying books, I'm much better at. But I believe that everyone has a thing that they are very good at. And thinking is what you are very good at. And you have been doing a phenomenal job of it.
Oh, thank you. You have a lot of time to think when you live on a ship and aren't very good at doing ship things, at least when you're a child. I've gotten a bit better now, but yes, it's been something I've practiced quite a bit.
Well, we are truly blessed to have you with us on this adventure. So
thank you.
We're good to have you around.
Can I let you in on something?
Of course.
I believe we all have different things that we're working towards, and I haven't really been very forthcoming with my own information in terms of why I know about the gods or like to read or have interest in the nameless as well. But do you know who the 8 exceptions are?
I don't know. What kind of check? Is that history or religion or?
I think that would fall under religion.
Religion? Okay. Let me find out if I know anything. Probably not. That's a plus 0, baby.
Baby.
That's a 3, baby. She's going to give you that, like, very confused, like, trying to nod, but also shaking her head and also kind of nodding and shaking, not really. No.
Well, so there were these people that had passed, and as you know, I care a lot about the passing of others, and I have my god that I follow, and 8 times in history, there have been people that have been made the exception to death. For whatever reason, it was judged that they deserved another chance and got to go back to living. I believe I am one of those people.
Oh.
The 9th. Exactly. And that it is my duty to bring the other 8 back. That's my hope, at least. So, if I ever seem caught up in things or sidetracked, just know that, you know, like the games are important to you, these 8 people are rather important to me. So I guess what I'm saying is, as a way to, I don't know, I just appreciate your comment. And perhaps while I provide to you my thinking, you can provide to me your assistance in my divine quest.
Well, quests I understand, and I am God-bound to assist in people's victories. And if your quest and if your victory is discovering these 8, and discovering if you are in fact the 9th of them, I am here to assist you on your quest.
I appreciate that so much. Perfect. I don't know if I want everyone else to know. There are some that look at my goal as well, you understand that these people I would be bringing to their deaths that they've been avoiding, and not everyone likes the sound of that or agrees with that quest, so I don't know if I want to tell everyone else yet, but I don't know, your compliment and your deeds have led me to trust you quite a bit, so at least for now I think maybe let's keep this between us.
Completely understood. My lips have been wax sealed.
Thank you.
I'm going to go pack and hopefully get a run in before we go.
Perfect. I have a little bit of reading to do, and I've been given a book for the road, so I'll just finish up what I need to leave behind.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
And Ariana will go off and if she comes across Tycheros, she'll tag Tycheros and go, "You're it," and run.
It's on.
Ariana, based on your character and what you just did and the fact that your character is a motivational speaker and so forth, I'm going to introduce a mechanic here. And I would like for you to roll a performance, if you would, please.
Yeah, absolutely. My performance. It's a 21. Sorry, that, 22. I'm plus 3.
Vara, you feel inspired by this, and you gain a d6 that you can use on any roll.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much.
All right.
Booyah. Oh, that's awesome. Thank you, Tam. That's so cool. I love it.
I think it fits, you know. So it's, cool.
That's awesome.
Yes.
All right.
We love homebrew mechanics.
You said you were going to go see Tycheros. Was there anything else you were going to do there?
I'm just tagging Tycheros and running and going to play tag with Tycheros.
Okay. Ptolemaeus, you're up.
Just a real quick question, actually. Do I actually pass the library on my way down? Because if I had a chance to go meet Prime, I will give him the page.
Okay.
I'll give Prime the page.
Well, since he's still working on the other one, and if you do that, he will swap with you. He will give you the copy, not the original. And okay. It's a pretty good copy. It's a fairly good copy. So he's actually just pretty good at this.
Just the symbols and everything. It's just basically a photocopy, right?
He even went so far as to shade in the creases in the paper from where it had been in the stack. I mean, it's as good a copy as you're going to get.
Perfect. Okay, yeah. Then if that's the case, then I'll just be like, thank you very much, Prime. I appreciate it.
You're very welcome. I like helping
and
people.
I'll just...
I like helping you.
Weird how that works. I'll just kind of awkwardly stare at him for a little bit longer. Just be like, very, very helpful indeed. Yes. Yeah. And I'll just take the page and just walk out of the library or where he was and wait for everybody.
All right. So several hours pass and they start gathering on the road. And the way this procession works is people just kind of start meandering into it and start. It's not some formal wagons ho type of thing. It's just people start going and more people go and more people go. So you get this very long trail of people on this pilgrimage to Akros. So you can join at any time that you want to.
As we march along, I'll kind of tap Tycheros on the back and kind of just be like, thanks for the ribbon. It does look nice.
It looks beautiful on you. You did so well.
Great. Oh, I'm sorry for sounding any bit accusatory when in my line of questioning, and I just I've always been looking for all these little connections and everything, and emotions isn't necessarily a thing that I'm best at. So if it was in any way awkward or imposing, I'm sorry. I apologize for that.
Oh, Ptoly. It wasn't terrible at all. You know, I'm sad but hopeful. I think my Tavi, I think he might be dead, but I just hold some hope. I'm not good with emotions either. I'm looking for things to, you know, one day I might find him. So I appreciate being prompted to think about him because I spend a lot of time running and I like you and it's all good.
Great. What was he like?
Oh, so handsome, so friendly, so good at potatoes. He would pick the potatoes better than anybody in the village. We had a potato farm. He had long black hair, beautiful face.
I think you mentioned that one before. Is there other things other than potatoes? Or picking the potatoes when it comes to being good at potatoes? Do you have to cook them?
Eating them. Oh, yes.
Fair enough. Oh. You know, that is interesting. I've never thought of produce as verbs in that way. And I'll just kind of continue this conversation for as long as we could, on the way.
Excellent. All right. So I assume everybody's joining together, beginning this procession and long march. And I am not going to make you go through several days of travel and trying to determine what wonderful events happen, because let's get to the fun part. Everybody wants to be at the games, right? So as you journey along, lots of conversations are being held around you. Sometimes you get ahead of other people in the procession. It's kind of a swap back and forth. There's no real formality to this. It's just a bunch of people going the same direction. There are wagons that are brought along that are just laden with alcohol and food. So it's a long street party forever as this thing trails along. And then you start hearing the conversations talking about side bets and who's betting on whom and who they think's going to win particular sessions. And at one point, this young man walks up and just kind of, "Oh, hello, guy. Hello, how are you all doing? Wait, you're Adrastos. You're the champion for Meletis, aren't you?"
"That's correct, I am. What's your name?"
"You can call me Iron Man. Yeah, Iron Man, that'll work. Yes.
Iron Man.
Yes, yes. That's Iroan. Yes. Good to meet you. I run a little side business. And I'm just curious, what events are you planning on participating in?"
"Well, checks notes. I wrote this all down. So, I wasn't sure. I figured I'd spread myself kind of wide, but of course, the Pankration, the Hoplite Run, and then," he kind of shifts his shoulders, "the Javelin Toss and the Discus."
"Quite a combination there. Curious, you're very stout. You look like you do really well in the combat games. How long have you been fighting in the gladiatorial circuits?"
"Probably the better part of the last 6 or 7 lunar cycles."
"Ah, so you're relatively new to it. And have you fought in any ranking type of combat? I mean, to be the champion, you must have a few titles to your name."
"Have I? Because backstory-wise, I probably would have, but I don't know if for the sake of this..."
I'm leaving this up to you. This would be pre your adventures in here, so feel free to embellish a bit.
Does Ariana step forward and pull out a bunch of ribbons?
"I have done I have placed in several places. Though I will admit, since we are apparently sharing and being honest, most of the championships that I have were not in organized circuits. To make my way up in the world before I was discovered by my wonderful trainer and fighting partner, Ariana of Akros, I was fighting..."
He now acknowledges you.
"I was fighting in more underground rings, things with less rules and a bit more blood. But yes, I have a few championships to my name.
Yeah.
And the council believes in promise. They don't believe that just because you have a bunch of titles means that you're deserving of a champion title.
Now, there was obviously an outstanding contender, but apparently for some reason she's not going to be included in the game. Someone, Myra, she was going to be in Heplodromus, the run, but apparently she won't be participating. How does that set your odds? What do you think that does for you in that competition?
Well, Mira was the finest combatant I ever had the pleasure of meeting, facing, or fighting alongside. She is the fastest woman I've ever met in armor. Sorry, Ariana. And I'll one of the strongest
that.
I've ever met as well.
I'll also
without her
that.
Here, I think my odds are pretty good.
Yeah, well, it's good for you. She dropped out and won't be here then.
I will be fighting in her honor. Any glory that I gain today will be hers as well. I refuse to take the glory and honor that should rightfully belong to someone else. That is not the Arescos way, that is not the Sunclaw way, and it is not my way.
So you're planning to throw the bout then?
Certainly not. I'm fighting in her honor. My victories are her victories.
Huh. In name, he is the council's champion. In spirit, he is Mira's.
Huh. You act as though she's unable to attend, rather than just dropping out of the round.
I'm sorry. What is your connection with all this? Is this idle curiosity, or are you driving at something?
Oh,
and at this point,
the
smile has faded from Adrastus' face.
I'm just collecting information. I deal in statistics. I deal in the math of determining how things may or may not go. And then I help people make determinations on that.
I see. Adrastos has dealt with these people when he was fighting in the underground circuit.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Mira is unable to attend, and I would not call it a stroke of luck that she is. Though I am happy to be representing her, I would be just as happy to be supporting her from the sidelines. I do not take glory or honor in her inability to attend, but yes, she is unable to attend. Her calling was higher and more important than any before us today.
Oh, I see. Well, must be very important. I have a curiosity. You speak as though you knew her well. Did you train with her at all?
I did.
Yeah. So, just in your friendly sparring, how did you do against her?
Well, it depended on the day. As I said, Mira was much faster than me, though I had her by a few pounds in brawn, and I was a fair bit stronger than her, so it really depended on our event. She had better aim, I hit harder.
All right. Thank you very much, and, best of luck to you. May Arois watch over and bless you through the games.
Simple nod.
Ariana will tap her chest a little bit at that.
I feel bad I skipped over one thing, so I want to back up for just a moment. When you went back to your room and you found the necklace on your bed, give me an idea what happened there. I apologize, Tycheros. I didn't mean to gloss over that.
So, Adrastos would pick it up. He would look to see if he could figure out who left it. He wouldn't try very long. He would just... Knowing the people who were in this house, he has an idea. He's narrowed it down to two people who it might be. He's not going to try to figure out which one of them it was. He either thinks it's Ariana or Tycheros. Not that the others... with maybe the exception of Agrios, wouldn't do something nice for him. I think Agrios doing something nice for him was him punching him in the face.
Yeah, I was
so,
about to say, I punched
but,
you, man.
Yeah, I was about to say, but like, our gift giving is different.
It's, yes, it's this violent. Isn't the type of good thing he would do.
But it doesn't seem like something that Ptoly and Vara would do, so that's why he's like, it's either Ari or Tycheros, but he would hold it and having just had his ancestor prayer, which was also not just to his ancestors, but to the rest of his clan. He would see this and he would just kind of close his hand around it, and probably manly tears would shed. And then he would put it on and make sure that it was tucked under his armor so that it was touching his skin. And nobody can see it but him.
Awesome. A couple of little lines through your fur down the side of your face.
Yeah. He wouldn't say anything because he figures if it was left in confidence that that is the way it should be kept. But he does walk with a bit more. He walks a bit more upright. The ancestor prayer, and this is something that Ariana would know. He's always a little bit mopey for like an hour after he does the prayer.
Okay.
But that doesn't last this time.
All right. Thank you very much. As you continue on through the day, about mid-morning through the second day, there's a young man running back and forth and seems a little out of breath as he's Agrios, acolyte of Mogus. Agrios, acolyte of Mogus.
That guy.
Yes.
Oh, are you? Oh, and he just looks worn out. It's obviously he has been running, trying to make his way through this procession for a day.
I am Agrios.
Agrios, acolyte of Mogus.
I bring you. What do you need of me?
I bring you a gift from the priests of the sacrificial altar, and he hands you a little pouch.
He takes it, examines it, and then opens it to see what's inside.
Inside you find three like slivers of material that have been crafted a bit. They've got some designs cut into them. They're a deep red in color.
Do I know what these are?
Probably not.
Did the priest tell you what these were?
Oh, he said, as one so dedicated to Mogus, may these help guide your way. Good journeys. And he kind of stops well. And collapses at the side of the road. Just
cool. And he just leaves him there collapsed.
Of course.
Ariana grabs a like,
I'm about to say Adrastos will look.
The water skin and
pick him up. Yeah.
I'm gonna leave him there because he's gonna go back to the town. But I'll give him like a skin of water.
Thank you. I'll be fine. Mogus will strengthen me. I just need to catch my second wind. Or third. Maybe fourth. And with that, as soon as he catches his breath and you move along, he will begin his walk back.
Are there any, like, the rest of the contestants and stuff are with this, right?
That they're somewhere spread throughout, yeah.
Okay.
They're not directly Ariana, with you.
Yeah. Ariana will, like, at some point over the 3 days, kind of, like, take a bit of a light jog, just to sort of scope out the competition.
All right. Now, not all competitors are coming from Meletis, but you will see a few who were there doing their practices. And what you come across A couple of probably warriors. They look like people who fought and are getting up there in age. This is probably their last games, you know, they're putting in for the hurrah.
Mm-hmm.
There is one guy who you can tell from his coloring and send, you know, his tan and the tattoos on him. He's a fighter. He comes from the farther inland areas of Theros. Definitely probably been fighting since the day he was born. He reminds you a little bit of Agrios, but he's not wearing any particular deity's colors or anything. Okay. There are a couple of hoplite soldiers who you've seen and probably encountered in some of your various things that you've met hoplites throughout the city. And that's it in this group of who's coming from Meletis.
Cool. She'll probably chat with them and like identify herself as like the trainer of one of the other combatants and whatever, and just have friendly conversation and like tell them that they look great. They look like they're doing a good job. Just be really encouraging to everybody, even the competitors. Well, yeah, because okay. If Adrastos wins against pathetic people, that's not a very good win, is it?
Yeah. And so. a couple of them give you some warnings and say, yeah, there's some kind of a person who handles wagers going around. Iron man something. Anyway,
Iron Man.
Watch out for him. That's him. Yeah, he's trying to gather information and figure out who the long shots are so that he can get better odds.
Oh, so we should be giving him completely false information so he really throws the bets.
And he laughs at it as well. Yeah, that's exactly what I did.
Very good choice. Lovely chatting with you, Jog.
Excellent. Ptolemaeus, you had a question or comment?
Oh my god, this is gonna bite me in the back. I wanted to see if in the procession, since everybody's warriors or people that are just in it for the party and everything and festivities, I can't shake that thought of the really pale guy in black. So I want to see if there's anybody that has something as dark and black as that cloak that I noticed in the morning.
All right. Give me an investigation check, as I assume you're going back and forth around looking.
Yeah. It is a 16.
Okay. As you move your way through this procession, you see a couple of times people in black. And it kind of draws your attention to them. But not specifically this person. They're similar. It's black cloaks and stuff. And it's a couple of them appear to be with some particular religious affiliation. And actually, they appear to be followers of Athreos. So something to do with them. But and they're mainly staying to themselves, but they occasionally get with other groups and talk with them, and you know, nothing really mischievous going on that you can tell. And you did spot someone else, and for a moment, and you actually thought they turned and looked at you. You just got this feeling. All you could see was, of course, the hood and the shadow it cast over them. And when you sped up a little bit to go see them, by the time you got to the cart they were with, they weren't there.
Okay. Sure. And then the other thing I would do is, after seeing someone run to go give Agrio something, I'll just, as a friend of some sort, I'll just walk up to the side of Agrios and be like, how is everything, Agrios? They told me I missed quite a lot.
Oh, yes, I suppose you did. I received her another prophecy, if you want to call it that, or two. And it was called into question whether any, or at least all of my prophecies have come from Mogis himself. And now it seems like at least one was a false prophecy from our enemy, intended to throw us off track. Which is very concerning indeed.
Do you know which one?
Yes, In the city, it seemed as though one of them was supposed to have come from Mogis. Part of their ploy, I suppose. Some sort of declaration of his wrath. Using crows to destroy the city. But, as was pointed out to me by the priest, Mogis did this with crows.
And I suppose that is why everybody else said you had some sort of a crisis.
Well, when a large part of your identity is constructed around the idea that you are an oracle of a particular god, when that idea is challenged, one tends to be left in crisis.
I believe, however, the challenge wasn't to you, and the fear is, should be that someone is challenging Mogis themselves. And as an oracle of Mogis, wouldn't you be one to defend them instead?
Yes, I have already vowed to take my vengeance on those who have given me these false words.
So not only does this, or not only does this steal your resolve, it should steal all of ours, that whatever we are facing here is quite powerful indeed.
Yes. Yes, it certainly must be. Don't worry. I have made a vow to destroy it, so I won't be going anywhere.
Oh, I thought you were going to go anywhere. We still have to drink in Citessa.
I'd nearly forgotten.
Well, here's to remembering.
And to not remembering so much. With how hard I expect us to drink.
That comes later. But for now, it is still a worrying prospect. And they knew where to strike if they used you. That meant they knew of your validity of some way, at least.
They know many things. I begin to be suspicious that we are surrounded by spies. If not in the air, then perhaps around us.
Yeah, I agree. And they, well, for one, I would have liked to have been there when the council appointed Adrastos their champion, because although congratulations are of order, the council, they do have their little games themselves.
That is, yes, without doubt, true. What is that one that irks someone?
the one that I thought that I had hoped to have been the target of the attack. His name's Drakios.
Drakios, yes. And he has that most unpleasant mage working under him.
Yeah, the brown noser that was just laying there the entire time.
Well, I'm not going to say what I was thinking about that, but yes, it seems odd that he's so attached to him when he sent him on a mission he expected to be a suicide mission.
That's the problem with these council members. They're very, very wily when it comes to their words. You don't know how young that they've brainwashed them, or how long, or how devoted people could be to people that have that sort of power and that sort of say.
The rest of us are just expendable to them, is that right?
You didn't hear it from me.
Well, far be it from me to start listening to authority now.
Even the good ones. Meletis, even. They have their own ploys. As in our position, as we are, we can only just tread between those lines.
What about you, Ptolemaeus? What's your ploy?
At this point, it's just fun, isn't it? All of it. I just want to see where it leads.
That I can agree with.
The stars in my hair, they continually move forward. And I don't plan on doing anything other than that.
And let us see where this road takes us.
Well, let's.
And with that, as the travel goes on, and you reach the third day, you come to a bridge. It spans a chasm that drops out so low that the mists cover the bottom. You cannot see all the way down. You have mountains to your left, and it goes to mountains to a valley on the right as it falls down towards the water. I apparently put a song in someone's heart there. I only wish their mic
mountains
was on.
Mountains to the left, you. Rivers to the right, here I am on a bridge in the middle with you.
I love it. Oh my goodness. So you begin on this journey across this bridge, and every 100 meters or so, there stands a set of guards, archers, and they have a burning, you know, a pair of wood burning in between them so that they can light arrows if needed. And they appear to be watching off the skies and off the sides of the bridge. And you roll onto this bridge and continue down it. It's this beautiful white marble. And it goes on and on. The first mile of the bridge, you're somewhat awed by the beauty of it and how it stands so tall between these. The mist below and the clouds actually touch and kiss the sides of the bridge. And when you get to about the end of the second mile, the clouds ahead part, and you see standing above you this 60-foot-tall statue a warrior, a hoplite in armor. The colossus of Akros rises from the mist as it stands across the gates and welcomes you into the city of Akros. As the procession makes its way through, people gather, cheers rise, and chants go of Iroas, 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 over and over. And Ariana, you had a question.
I'm from Akros. So this is like coming home. Okay.
Yeah. Cool.
She'll walk up to the statue and kind of put a head down on it. And if there's like a traditional thing, you leave. Okay. Yeah. And then join in the chants.
Excellent. Excellent. You make your way in, and with that, the torches are lit, and you have entered the city, and they now can pronounce the game's begun. And the party has just arrived in Akros and passed under the gates, the colossus of Akros, which guards the gates. And you are in the city. What would you like to do?
First, I want to make sure, does it count as a long rest for us to have?
Absolutely. This trip's long enough and you would have stopped along the way. Everyone's long rested, so heal up.
Perfect.
Power up.
Heal that massive damage from Akrios' fist.
No, that's permanent. That remains. No,
okay. No, that's fine. I'll wear that as a badge of honor. No. Just a hoof print on the side of my face.
Oh, no. If I'd used my hooves, it would have been more damage.
I'm about to say. Ariana will probably walk over to Agrios and just say, if anyone gives you trouble here, you send them to me.
Oh.
I mean, deal with them as you will, but if you don't feel like it, send them afterwards. Send them to me.
Oh, you know I'll feel like it. I've wanted to pillage this city ever since I saw its walls.
Not terribly pillageable, but very desirous to be pillageable.
How's a very ambitious child?
Yes, I can see that. Don't ever lose it.
Never change.
Never change, Agrios.
I haven't yet.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, should we be... Adrastos and maybe me will have lodgings as the champion of Meletis, but I'm assuming the rest of us will have to deal for ourselves. There's plenty of inns. We may be able to stop at the temples. Agrios may get an eye or two, but we'll be welcomed.
Would the arena not provide lodging for us for our train? I mean, you are, at least for as far as I can claim you on lodging, you could be counted as my attendants.
This is true. Well,
not that I think of you that way at all, but we are all equal in this group.
Thank you for clearing that up. No, I'm pretty sure we could try, but there's definitely going to be places to stay.
You know, you might be better off anyway. It's going to smell rank in the arena place, which, you know.
You think military lodgings are bad? Whew.
Oh, wait.
Question out of character. There's like no, like, you know, Olympic Village or anything to do with this area. No, none of that. It's just do as you will. Not that part of it.
As you enter the city, the one thing that is unmistakable, aside from the colossus whose legs you just walked through, you know, whatever, or under, no looking up the kilt there, okay, is the stadium. And I just put up a map of it. So the center of Akros is this enormous stadium. It stands and towers above everything else. But as far as an Olympic Village, no, people they didn't have quite the same entourage back then. And it wasn't, you know, people coming from all these distant lands to do this that had to be catered to. No, it wasn't a dollar event. This is all about the game. Anybody could show up, and if they earned a spot, they could participate in these games. No doubt. There are people who would show up day of, prove themselves, and be able to be in the games. Absolutely no doubt. So, no, it didn't really have a sidestep place for that. So there may be places to stay, but it'll be more like a tent village than a permanent location.
Got it.
Yes, I mean, we came here with a procession, and I assume everyone that is part of this procession needs somewhere to go, so we could probably keep proceeding to lodgings.
Is there any place that I would know of? Because like the games are every year, right?
Yes.
Okay. So there's probably like the standards that everybody goes to and all the places that like cater specifically to visitors for this. Are there any like off the beaten track housings or inns or things like that?
Yeah, there's some areas that are more residential, and people have set up, because knowing the games are in town, they have places set up for that. And in fact, probably people you know, since this is your hometown. So absolutely, you could find some people and set up a home, and it wouldn't be a too bad of a fee. You know, they would do it. They'd probably offer you a discount, being who you are. It may only be a large room. Large being, you know, like a 20 by 20 or something like that, rather than anything, you know, like you were getting back at the council mansions. But yeah, it'll be a place to stay.
I likely know some folks that tend to rent out spaces while people are in town for the games. If that's amenable to you, we can definitely go inquire. Otherwise, if everyone would like their own rooms, there are many inns and places that we can stay. But
I think staying with someone you know or trust would probably be a good idea. We do tend to discuss things that we don't want listening ears hearing. So, agreed. Yes, I like the sound of that.
I think that is probably the best course of action for us.
Wonderful. Everyone else, Adrastos, did you want to stay at the Colosseum, or would you like to come with us?
Again, going back to keeping up appearances, I think it would look strange if a competitor did not stay with the other competitors. Any sort of tampering could be implied, and if nothing else, people would be looking into us, and better I stay separate, I think. For now, well, at least.
How does everyone feel about going to the Colosseum, checking Adrastos' room in, and getting an eye on what's happening before we go investigate space for ourselves?
Perfect.
Wonderful.
Makes sense.
Confidently head off for the knowing exactly where to go.
Mm-hmm. All right. As you are making your way past the stadium, which you obviously have to do to get anywhere in the city, trumpets sound, and everyone stops. This is a bit unusual. It's trying to get attention. And on the rim of the stadium, it's kind of a flat, wide space so that you could walk along the top of it. You see a procession of five people carrying a flag of the Temple of Aros, walking on the edge. And they get to the edge and turn. And then, obviously, the person doing this is using some form of thaumaturgy as their voice just bellows out across the entire city. We welcome all to Akros for the Iroan Games. And, of course, the crowd just goes wild. Run. I come with word from Iroas himself. There have been threats made against the games. and Iroas wants it made clear. These games are under his protection, and no one, especially no follower of Mogus, shall disrupt these games. Mogus, hear this clearly. These games are protected. Your people are welcome to participate, but you shall not interrupt what happens here. With that, be it known that magic is not allowed for use in the Iroan games. These games are to be challenges of strength and might and personal energy. And as such, we will be dampening all magic within these walls. Victory to the strongest!
Drastos is going to lift his shield and give a nice hearty Leonin roar in response.
And there's the crowd just yells and screams. Everybody's thrilled and ready to go with this. And with that, the procession leaves the edge of the stadium.
And this guy talks a lot of shit.
Except there is one thing that I want to mention. Ariana, do you know anything that's outside of these walls that we could go to? For our safety purposes.
I guess there wouldn't be any, like a small farming village outside, just outside the walls.
There are some things around. I mean, it's a very mountainous region, but there would definitely be some areas outside the gates. Obviously not the gates you came in, because that's just a chasmous pit. You wouldn't want to try sleeping out there. But on the north side of town, through those gates, there's some area that's been carved out, some farming and stuff that goes on. There would be some land that you could probably pitch a tent on, if nothing else.
Perhaps there are some cities outside, some small towns and or small groups, single farmhouses and such. I do worry we should be close. If things, from what has happened thus far, the worst of it has happened in cities.
That's the problem. We should be close, yes, but if it happens in the city, and half of us can't do anything about it.
How so?
The magic happening.
Sorry, was that within the walls of the city, or was it within the walls of the Colosseum?
It really wasn't said. It just said within the bounds of these where the games are held. So
okay.
It could be either. It's hard to know which.
Okay. It would be odd for them to put it in the whole city. This is a town of Iroas. There are many paladins, clerics, followers that would be without. The healing would be without. Perhaps we should inquire on specifications.
Just in case, yes.
You make a good point.
Give me a perception check, Ariana.
Ooh. That's a not super great. Oh no, 13.
Okay, that's good enough. You hear some other questioning from other people that you're not the only ones that have this question about what's going on. So
because this isn't like normal. They don't normally have some magic dampening thing.
No, this is obviously a special situation due to the threats that were stated that somebody yelled out in Meletis out of nowhere about destroying the games and, you know, in the name of Mogus or something. So, you know, I don't know who that could have been.
Listen, that might have been with my mouth, but I didn't do
it. I didn't do it.
I'm sure that everyone understand and agrees with that.
Ariana's making sure she walks close to Agrio so it's clear that they're together.
Now, one place that you know of is the Temple of Aros Primakos. that is who the flag appeared to be. You're familiar with this, of course, being from Akros. Mm-hmm. So if you have a question, probably that would be the place to go ask.
Yeah, sorry, was it pro-Makros or pro-Akros?
P-R-O-M-A-K-O-S. You will find there are different aspects of each of the gods everywhere you go, so the temple is named to that particular aspect of the god. So in this, it's Iroas Primakos. If you go to another place, there will be another name for another aspect of who he is.
10-4. Well, there's a temple nearby for the from Iroas Primakos, and perhaps seeing that was where it came from, we should check with them. If Agrios is receiving insight from alternative sources, perhaps he's not the only one.
Agreed. We'll follow your lead then, since it is your hometown.
Right. Well, head off.
All right. So you're headed to the temple to make sure I understood correctly. Your
yes. Right. Yeah. Double check.
All of your. All of you are going together? Okay.
You don't have to come in.
Okay. It's great. You realize you've reached this temple when you start seeing the statuaries of warriors fighting minotaurs and defeating them that line the entryway. And there's a large statue at the end that is Iroas pinning Mogus to the ground in defeat as he subdues him in battle.
At this point, Agrios is going to lean over to Ariana.
Listen, ma'am, I promise not to disrupt the games, but is a little bit of friendly vandalism off the table?
I would argue that's brotherly competition, as is a little vandalism. Maybe wait till it's a little darker out.
Or at least until everyone's distracted.
Yes.
Don't get caught.
Just walks by. Perfect. Yeah, let's go in.
All right. You enter the temple, and there are various rituals and ceremonies going on around it. You are approached by an acolyte in a white and golden robe bearing the sigils of Iroas.
And agree.
May I help you?
We were hoping to confirm what you meant by magic dampening. Is that within the Colosseum or within the town?
The whole time you're talking, the acolyte is looking your direction, but the acolyte's eyes are looking at Agrios.
Does Agrios still have the symbol of Mogus painted on his face from the temple in Meletis?
I would say yes. Unless you washed it off.
I would also say yes. No, he wouldn't wash it off.
All right.
Now it's old. Well, it's old, 3-day old goat blood.
That is Agrios's aesthetic.
Fair.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you remember the grime.
That's
the grime slurry.
That, yep, exactly. That's he accumulates perfect. These things. He doesn't get rid of them.
I love it.
The aspect is that the stadium will be covered at all times and any place wherein the games are going. So that may be in the amphitheater, if there's, well, the race that is from here and back to Meletis. Obviously, there will be people going along to protect that as well. Anywhere that a threat from anyone. Oh, yes. And she specifically looks at Mogus. At Agrios, and from anyone who might cause trouble at the games.
Well,
Yeah, in the event that trouble occurred, if there was magic dampening, are there people who are at the ready to protect? I guess city guard and...
Oh, absolutely. The entire guard is on call, and they've brought in soldiers from other polis as well to help.
Well, good to know.
We have several thaumaturges from Meletis that came along as well. I believe they're answering to Eurymedes. I believe that is his name.
Good to know. Wonderful.
Great.
He's here.
Yes, he came in the procession.
I see. That's good to know. Glad they're in good hands.
It appears, and she kind of snuffles a little bit, it appears as though you've had a long journey. May I recommend one of the bathhouses, and specifically looking at Agrios? They could help you freshen up, say.
Fine. Do you need to wash up, Ariana? Are you saying she smells? I don't think so.
I don't believe it is her, but there is definitely
we did just travel for 3 days with a large procession.
Yes, Adrastos sniffs his underarm. Nope, it's me.
We could all use some washing up.
You said there's multiple temples to Yaros here, right?
Yes.
I presume I would have like trained with a singular one.
Or would I jumped around? You might have jumped around between them until you picked one to be your primary affiliation. What aspect of Iroas do you find yourself most drawn to?
Predominantly just the victory aspect, like the overcoming of it.
Then you are in the correct place.
Perfect. I'm wondering if there's anyone here that I would know.
Possibly. Everyone seems to be quite busy at the moment.
Yeah.
So there's a lot going on. Okay. You know what? Roll me a perception check.
Cool. That's 14 plus 3, 17.
As you think about this, you recognized the priest who was giving the speech from the top of the stadium, Lanathos.
Lanathos?
Yep. It is someone you would be familiar with.
Oh. Lanathos!
Oh, please, there are many things going on here today. Lanathos is not here at the moment. He was giving a speech over towards the stadium, and I think
meant I recognized him like he walked by.
Sorry.
That's my bad.
No problem.
Can I leave a note for Lanathos, please?
Of course. I'll have to fetch some paper. I don't have any at the moment. Oh. Or you could just tell me if you'd like.
She'll pull out a piece of parchment or book or something and just like rip a corner off of it.
Okay.
It's just like a little piece of charcoal. Lanathos, am in tune. See you at games. ? Ariana.
All right.
And hand it to her.
Right. I will see that he gets this after his meeting with the group from Meletis.
We are part of that group.
No,
this is a champion.
I meant the thaumaturges. They're going to be setting up the anti-magic areas.
Right. And that was Eurymedes that did that.
Yes. Yes. He was the main contact from there. Apparently he is quite a powerful sorcerer.
And that's our cue to leave and find lodging, I believe.
What on earth are you talking about, Talibaeus? yes, perhaps it is. We've stunk up your reception enough.
Oh, I can take care of that clearly. And prestidigitation, she kind of freshens the air around it.
Smart ass. Continuing on, turn around and head out.
There is no, I could feel my magic not being dampened here right now, right?
Correct.
Okay, as we leave, I will, as kind of like understanding that was a little bit of a slight, I'll just mimic Adrastos' smell again as I presto it while in the reception while we walk out. And it's just like, really?
And you see as she, and then there's a new waft of this flowery smell trying to cover up.
You know, sometimes people are it's not that they're rude, it's just they're not traveled. And it happens. I'm sure the mural meant nothing. Well, it definitely meant something, Agrios, but...
I imagine we'd find a similarly reversed mural in a temple of Mogus.
There wasn't enough of blood in this one.
Mm-hmm. That one may have even been drawn in blood in the Mogus Temple.
Very fine artistry, if that's the case.
Shall we to the Colosseum?
Yeah.
Yeah. When are the games starting?
They will actually be starting in the evening.
Exciting.
Is it super busy right now? Where we are, like everyone's rushing.
There's lots of people milling around everywhere, and you have people coming in and out of the temple looking for blessings and offering gifts.
Okay.
You'll see this at pretty much any temple at this point in the city. So.
Fair.
Yeah.
Ariana tosses a piece of. She still has her piece of charcoal in her hand. She kind of tosses it over her shoulder at Agrios. It doesn't look. Look at this beautiful architecture over here.
He'll take that and secret it away. He had other ideas in mind, but that might work.
Adrastos will take the lead walking to the temple. You're muted, Ariana.
You're muted. Yeah,
so you gotta do some outlining before you do any real good vandalism.
Right. So you're headed back to the stadium, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Sorry, yeah, stadium, not temple.
Okay. All right. So you're wandering around, and Ariana, since you know most of the city, I would assume you're going, oh, and this is this, as you're walking through, pointing out various
locations. Knocked my head so hard jumping out of that window. They'd replaced the awning, and apparently they hadn't stapled it right, so I went right through.
In fact, very near to that location, you see a sign. Of a room for let.
Perfect. This works, eh? Close enough, yet far away enough?
Seems good.
I would say so.
And you recognize this house? Well, at least you know who it used to belong to. I mean, you haven't been gone that long. So this would be the home of Ectri and Samath. And I'll send you their names if you want to know how to spell it. So.
That would be lovely. Every name in this, I have just been making it up and gone, yeah, this is how it sounds. Good enough.
Close enough. Yeah.
I'll be able to say it correctly.
I'm probably not. But go for it.
Say it enough that you know who I'm talking about.
There we go.
I'll go knock on the door.
And... the door opens, and Thectory answers, and Ariana! Big hug.
Hey! Yeah.
Samath! And so Samath comes in, and she gives you a big hug as well.
Yep. I see you have a room for let. Do you think you can accommodate six? Six and a half, if you count Agrios.
And then she starts to say, of course, and then she looks around and sees Agrios standing in the back, and will he have trouble with the stairs?
I'll look back.
Always.
But we overcome troubles, don't we?
Yes, that we do. No stairs will stop me.
There you are.
We do have the stable for the donkey out back if you wanted to share with. I don't mean to be rude, but
how dare you? Do you know who I am? I'm joking. I sleep in stables all the time.
I'm sure whatever would be most comfortable.
You're welcome. You're welcome inside. I'm just afraid that the hallways and stuff might not be convenient. You're welcome to try, but I'm afraid they didn't build this house with centaurs in mind.
Typical.
So few places do. It's the problem with the world today. But yes, would you mind? These are my friends. This is Vara, Tycheros, Ptolemaeus. You've met Agrios. This is my pupil, Adrastos.
Oh, a pleasure to
Not
meet
really,
you.
I just trained him.
Oh. Oh, okay. Welcome. Come in. We were just preparing dinner. They'll be preparing for the game's opening ceremony soon and the initial round of the Pankration.
Excellent.
Do participants often die in Pankration?
Not often, but occasionally. They also have quite a few wounded.
Yes, dangerous stuff. But we couldn't impose.
There are only two rules in Pankration. No biting and no magic.
I'm running into this no magic thing a lot. No biting, really.
Yes, no
biting. I mean, I wasn't planning to do that anyway, but here we are.
I suppose Adrastos biting might be worse than one of us.
No wonder there's such a high survival rate.
Well, the survival rate might be high, but the survival rate might be high, but so is the maiming rate, apparently.
I mean, that's the next best thing, right, Agrios?
We all love a good maim.
So will any of you be participating in the Pankration?
I will.
Oh, interesting. How does the oil work with your fur? It seems like that would be... Oh, you're not... Are you shaved under your armor?
A gentleman does not tell, ma'am.
Well, I think everyone will know shortly, of course.
Well,
he giggles.
You'll just have to wait and see, and I'll give her a wink.
All right, so they will show you up to this room, which is it's a large room. There were a couple of beds in it because they were expecting a couple of people to let the room. So they will rapidly go around and try to find, you know, things to make up places to sleep around it. Agrios, I'm going to give you credit that if you want to get upstairs without damaging the house, you can do so. But that's up to you.
Oh, I'll give it a shot, yeah.
All right. So he squeezes his way up and makes it up the stairs.
Oh, Agrios wants to stay with his friends instead of moping in the stables.
I mean, you know, if they're making the offer, he's going to take it.
Oh, you get a view out the window.
I mean, it's not an honor.
Apparently, my headphones died.
He slept outside a lot.
Sorry, I missed some of that. My headphones died at just that wonderful opportune moment. So,
I'm just saying it's not an offer that he gets a lot. He has slept outside most of the time. So, you know, as long as it's there, he might as well take it.
It's entirely up to you. I mean, the donkey's a good looking donkey. You can take a look out the window and hey,
no, 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 no. Creepy like horses.
All right. Very well.
Not going to make friends with that donkey.
All right. So you all are settled in. They prepare some food and, you know, get everyone prepped up and everything. Anyone, anything you want to do before the game, time to go to the games for the opening ceremony in the first round?
I'll just have, since everybody's here, it's like, okay, so now that everybody's here, and I, this might be nothing, but just so everybody could make sure they could keep an eye out. It was just rather odd. When I was running back before the crows, when I was getting back to the house, there was a person that I noticed was staring out in the sky in the opposite way of when the sun was rising, and also was one of the most pale creatures I've ever seen. And in days of festivities, wearing a completely black cloak. Now, I understand that followers of Athreos also sometimes wear these black cloaks, but this one in particular was odd. Nobody else was looking in the same direction as he was. And I want everybody to at least keep that in mind.
I will be sure to keep a lookout myself.
But other than that, Adrastos, normally I have these words of inspiration that I want to say to people, or I try to logic out something that would help with you in this situation, but just know that we all believe you in you, and that you're one of the strongest fighters that I know that stand on two legs.
Very diplomatic, Ptoly, thank you.
Indeed.
All right.
It's all right.
The time
I'm fighting for two today.
Yeah.
That's right. Adrastos is pregnant.
Yes, Adrastos is pregnant. That's what I figured.
Congratulations.
All right. So, Adrastos, knowing how the Pankration event is done, are you wearing your armor to the stadium or going as you will be fighting?
Nope. I'm going as I will be fighting. I'm going to strut my stuff down the streets of Akros.
All right.
yeah, just following in Ariana's footsteps, apparently.
I was trained well.
So you make your way to the stadium, and you're running a little behind schedule, but you're there for the opening ceremony. There are speeches being made and things, and welcoming to the Iroan Games. And then you hear the announcement. All competitors for Pankration, please join in the Red Fourier so that we can select your opponents.
I'll turn back to my party and just standing as tall as I can, and then I'll head in.
Ariana will catch him beforehand and do okay. Like a hand on shoulder, forehead to forehead,
mm-hmm.
And just have a little... Krista doesn't have a full speech ready, but something talking about one of the competitions that he was in, that he was almost out of it, but he didn't, and he persevered and he got over it.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to do the Sun Claws proud.
Yes, I believe that I am. And then before I leave, I'll just put my hand on her shoulder and whisper, "For Mira."
For Mira.
All right.
What are the rest of you going to be doing while Adrastos is preparing for this and competing? Are you going to find Tycheros. A place to sit in the stadium or what? Sorry, go ahead, Tycheros.
No, Tycheros, I was just going to jump in and say she's going to take her new researcher duties very seriously. She's going to pull out this weird broken eyeglass, and like she's going to be peering around the stadium, thinking she's being surreptitious and looking for anything weird or anything to write in her notebook that is looking odd or scary.
Give me a perception check and we will come back to that a little bit later during the session.
Is there centaur seating in the stadium?
You know what? There's centaur standing. You know, not necessarily seating, but it's That's laid fine. Out. It's laid out that look, you could mix in with the party if you wanted to, or go off by yourself.
We can just lock our legs, and that's pretty much resting in a standing position anyway.
Yep.
That does remind me of something, though. If I'm going in full Pankration, I would have been wearing the necklace.
Yes.
Up until the head-to-head, and then I would have taken it off and put it in Ariana's hand and said, "Keep this safe."
He would have put it on.
But Tycheros would have seen him wearing the necklace.
Excellent.
Ariana,
which up until that point, it would have been hidden.
Yeah. Ariana looks slightly confused when she takes it and is like, "All right," pockets it.
All right. So the rest of you are going to sit as a group in the stadium somewhere, I assume. We'll say you get pretty decent seats. You're not in the nosebleeds. You're not right down up front, but you know. Ariana knows people, so they're going to get her in a good place. So
yeah, I don't want to brag, but I'm kind of a big deal.
Adrastos,
you walk. She's just friends with the ticket takers.
Adrastos, you walk into the the red foyer, and there is a group of about 50 to 60 warriors in there, all dressed for the battle. Meaning they are dressed at fighting weight. For those who don't know, you are measured for fighting weight naked. These are the Olympics. This is how it goes. Many of them are well-oiled. Obviously, if you have fur, you're probably not. And I need you to roll me a d20 so we can figure out who your first opponent will be.
Right.
I am so...
Kind of like how people like shade to make their abs look more defined. I just imagined like shaving.
He's got little grooves.
Yeah, just to accentuate what's there.
Three. Well, it's funny because the I would have like, you know, lion coloration, so I'm a little bit differently colored.
Yeah.
But yes, three.
All right. So Your opponent is selected out, and you can tell a little bit from the accent. She's from Citessa. She is one of the guards. She's a Citessan hoplite. And being the respectful warrior that she is, she comes up. She only comes up to about here on you. And she's tall, but, you know, you're very tall. So
yeah.
She is slim but quite muscular. And she wishes you luck, and
I will offer her my hand in that, like, so that we can do the 4-on-4-arm thing, and they'll say, "Fight right. well, warrior."
All right. You as well. I wish you well, but I obviously hope you fail.
No, of course. And same to you, but fight well.
Right. So just before you go out. So all of you will be fighting. There are various places around the ring. You'll be escorted to your spot. When the horns blow, the fight begins. Remember, no magic, no biting. You will fight until your opponent is defeated, downed, unconscious, or dead, or they surrender. You surrender by raising your index finger. Yes, Adrastos.
So out of game, because I have two different styles of unarmed damage similar to Agrios, am I using the larger size?
That is up to you and how you're fighting. You tell me what you want to do and what you want to throw as a punch. It is entirely
rules don't include no fighting or no scratching.
I'm not angry enough yet to like put claws in, so we'll start barefisted. But
okay, it is not magical. It is part of your body, so it counts.
And it's not biting.
So yeah, it's not biting.
As Arya said.
Yeah. All right. So you are escorted out, and all of you, fortunately. Just because the DM's good fortune and everything else, you got great seats. You can see right down there, right down in front of you. Beautiful. Ariana, you see your pupil, your mentee, towering over this young Citessen. And you immediately wonder if she's going to survive. But anyway...
I see them? But once Agrios says that, I'm going to turn and see that my party is together, and I'm going to raise the golden sashed arm to them.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Everybody raises their ribbons.
All right. The horn sounds. Please roll initiative, Adrastos. I have an 11.
19.
All right. Well, I would say that puts Adrastos first.
All right.
So Adrastos, your first punch.
Yeah, Adrastos drops down into his guard a little bit because having been a martial artist, I know that just because that being taller is actually a bad thing. And I'm going to try and like get low and like just connect with my shoulder kind of into this like a tackle.
All right. Go ahead and roll the attack for me.
All right. Oh dear. That is 24.
That is an absolute hit.
All right. So I'll just come in with my shoulder, get it right in the gut. And if I'm doing just regular unarmed damage, that's just 4.
Okay. You hit her so hard, it lifts her off the ground. And you hear the air rush out of her, and she hits the ground and stops for a moment. You can tell she's catching her breath.
I will whisper under my breath, "Come on, champion, fight."
She's going to put up her fists, and she turns and she launches a kick at you. What is your unarmored AC, by the way?
It's 10.
And should be. I was just making sure you didn't have anything special in there.
Yeah, no. Right.
That is an 18.
All right, that'll hit.
As she launches that and connects, and she actually hits you pretty powerfully. She's going to catch you right in the chest, and that is going to be 4 bludgeoning.
4, okay. All right, I will take it, and I'll just, like, move back. All right, and then I'm going to do a feint. So I'm going to use my fainting maneuver, which gives me advantage on this attack. And if I hit, I get to roll a d8 and do that extra damage.
Yep.
So I will slip around, hopefully slip around her guard. 23.
Yeah, that's an absolute hit.
Okay. Well, I had to make sure she could be.
Nope, you're smacking her around.
All right, so that is a d8 that I just threw into the cosmos there. So I'll try that again. That is 10 damage.
Oh my.
So what I want that to be is I'll kind of go like I'm going again, and when I see her block, I'll duck and then uppercut her right in the chin.
Okay. And when you do this, it knocks her head back and you hear a pop. And blood starts coming from her mouth. She apparently had her tongue in the wrong place and she's cut her tongue in this fight. And she looks a little dazed. She shakes her head for a moment and she backs off with a hand up. So she is going to miss her turn on this one. And you are okay. Up again.
All right. Well, Adrastos is caught between like honorable combat and gotta win. So I'm just going back in for another hit. I will not use feints this time.
Okay.
I should have. I missed.
Okay. So you do that. And with that, she kind of catches her second burst of energy. Hey, maybe I've got a chance here. And she is going to... Did you throw a punch, kind of, or was it a charge?
It was a punch, yeah.
Okay, so she is going to touch your arm as it goes by and attempt to punch up into your armpit. And that is going to be a 19.
Yep.
All right. And that is only going to do 3 bludgeoning damage.
All right.
As she hits you square in there. But, you know, it kind of gives you that Charlie horse right here. Yeah, that Charlie centaur right here in your left arm. So,
all right. So I'm going to use that. So I'm going to, like, take that, put my other hand on top of this hand, and drive my elbow into the top of her head.
All right.
Hopefully. 11?
That's a hit.
Cool. 4 more damage.
Your arm comes down on the back of her head, and she goes face first into the dirt and doesn't move.
I'm going to back up to like make sure that...
No mercy!
So one of the officials, seeing that she is down, is going to come over, roll her over, and check on her. And he's immediately going to summon over a couple of the medical crew, and he is going to walk over and raise your arm.
And I will raise my other arm and just roar, for the sun glow!
So, in the crowd, what's happening up there with his party?
Agrios almost boos for no execution, but then quickly switches to, yeah! Adrastos, it's been going nuts this whole time. The worst was when blood first started showing. Everyone sitting next to him is probably regretting sitting next to him.
Whoever is sitting next to Ariana is getting picked up, like jumped, shaken.
It's not somebody in your party. It's just the person
probably
happens
not,
to
no,
be
just
there.
Some person.
Tycheros, says you're looking around at this and the victory happens, you see the arm go up in the L and you put this back up to your eye. You know, when you throw it back up to your eye, you're not looking the same area you were. You're kind of looking at one of the entrances and you see a figure in a black cloak. And you can't quite make out the face under this cloak, even through the great magnification of this. Something just seems distorted a bit. But you get
Ptoly,
a view.
Ptoly.
The light goes under and you can see the corner of their face and it's very, very pale, kind of white. And give me your
That's what Ptoly was talking about.
Let's see. What did you get on your perception? It was a 17. I think that's
17.
Good enough.
Yeah.
And
erase over, yeah.
For a moment. It brings back a memory. It is a memory of a day in the forest. You were on a picnic. And Tavi was standing over you. And the light was coming through the trees. And it hit just the same type of area on the face and lit it up. And then the memory just fades.
Oh, that's weird, she thinks to herself. But she's like, Ptoly. She shakes it off. Ptoly, is that the figure you saw? You told us a pale figure and a hood? And I point and just see if they've disappeared or not.
Can I, from here, like without any magnification, I could just see like a black blob, right?
It's the other side of the stadium. It would be very difficult to make anything out, yeah.
I'd have to trust you on this, because the shadows makes it kind of seem like it's just going to be black. I don't even know if there's someone there.
Look through my glass.
I'll just grab it and just be like.
You see people cheering as the fighting is continuing and several matches are wrapping up along the base in there. But there's nobody standing in that stairwell.
Like, it could have been just a shadow. I don't think I see anything there.
Okay. I grabbed the glass back. I'm going to keep looking. I saw something. I'm keeping on looking.
Okay, well, if you saw a glimpse, that's trouble. That spells trouble. And I will... Where did you get that, by the way? Do you have another one?
No, just this one, but I can get you one.
Could you?
Yeah.
I think that would really help us.
Sure.
But then after that, I will look over and see that probably, afterwards, Adrastos already won and everything, and I will cheer along with everybody else. Definitely not as loudly as Agrios or Ariana, because I don't really understand any of this, but okay, it's fine. It's sure.
The matches have completed, and several, obviously a victor and failure and on multiple sides. You see a couple of people being carried off with wounds that look like they may be permanent. There's one arm that is definitely bent in a direction that is not the correct direction.
Ooh, that doesn't go that way.
But there's a short break as you are all drawn back in, giving time to rest. And basic medical, no magic, obviously, but basic medical attention if needed.
Okay, so does that constitute a short rest or no healing at all?
That will constitute a short rest.
Cool. Take a short rest.
Now, keep in mind, you've got a few more matches to go, so it's up to you if you want to take that now and use it or not, because you're only going to get a couple of short rests.
I'm pretty good right now, I think.
All right.
On a scale of 1 to 28, I'm at about a 21, so I think I'll be okay.
That's not too bad, yeah. All right, let's get ready for your next round. Please roll me a d20.
15. Man, Frankendice is going great tonight.
15. Which one of these is 15? Uh-oh.
I don't like that at all.
Excellent. So after about a 30-minute break, they're brought back out. And Adrastos, you are taken out to your place in the ring, but your competitor is not with you. And they're like, don't worry, they'll be here in a moment. They were purging themselves, apparently. So after a few minutes, they guide out this obviously intoxicated satyr.
It's a drunken master.
I mean, he is just completely tossed. He's kind of wandering around. He comes up and walks up to you and gives you a big hug and going, this is going to be fun. How are you?
I'm going to tap him on the back. Yes, it is. I'm looking forward to it. And then just pick him up and put him down at arm's length.
I'm Dimmy. Great to meet you.
Pleasure to meet you as well. Let's do honor to the games.
I'm apparently filling in for somebody. They didn't do so well after the first round, but so what is this? Is this like cards or something? And at that point, the horn blows. And please roll initiative. I'm rolling initiative with disadvantage.
Okay. 9.
That still beats mine. I got a 2.
Okay. Adrastos is again of two minds here, because on the one hand, he's like, I feel bad for this guy. He might not know what he's getting into. But on the other hand, he's like, I don't trust this man. I'm going to punch him in the nose. So that's what he does.
And you can do this attack with advantage because he is just standing there with this dumb look on his face. Like,
22 damage.
To hit or damage?
22 damage. No, 22 to hit.
He's gone.
You know? I just punch his head off. No, 22 to hit.
Yes, that is a definite hit.
4 damage, just a jab to the nose.
And you punch him in the nose, and all of a sudden he goes from drunk to this sober, and he blood's just pouring out of his nose, and he grabs it and he goes, "What? Why'd you hit me? I don't understand." And he turns around. "I don't understand what's happening." And
then hold up one finger.
You're up.
Hold up one finger.
He's just looking. What?
Last chance. Hold up one finger. I'm going to hit you again.
You're up.
Okay. He did not hold up one finger. Is this also with advantage?
No, this will just be regular.
Okay, then I missed.
All right.
I assume.
You take a swing at him. So he's like just moves to the side as your punch goes past him. And he turns around and what are you? And he takes and he slaps at you.
Okay.
And he tries to slap and he like just barely grazes you, and it's like this most soft, limp-wristed hit ever. It's just like a kind of a brushing across your chin.
Okay. I will turn around and I will say, "Hold up one finger!" And I will use Daunting Roar to try and frighten him. Because I can do this as a bonus action and still punch him.
And he looks at his hands and he goes, "What? You hit me!"
And now I'm angry, so I'm just going to like catch him across the chest.
All right.
Does a 13 hit?
Just, yes.
Okay.
Somewhere in the stands, you just hear a shout out,
"Come, Adrastos! His flesh will nourish you for the next battle."
So because I'm angry and I didn't quite pull my fingers in all the way, he's going to take 7 slashing damage.
Oh, all right. So here he is now, still dealing with the blood coming from his nose, and now he has these claw marks that are bleeding on him. And he just looks up at you and puts his head down and charges at you.
I hope he hits.
And that is going to be a 14 to hit.
That'll hit.
All right. Sorry, I should have rolled damage with it. And that is going to be 7 bludgeoning damage as he rams you with his horns. Kind of goes like he's just running through you, turns around, and charges back at you again. And that is going to be a 7, which I don't believe will hit you. So.
Well, then, when he charges again, I will be using one of my superiority dice to backhand him with riposte, because he missed.
Okay.
So this is my reaction. 15.
That's a hit.
13 slashing damage.
You cut across him, straight across. Blood is pouring out profusely from him, and he collapses to the ground.
Medic!
And some people immediately run over and they are doing everything they can, and one of them's, you know, like he's trying to cast a healing, and then he realizes this isn't going to work in here, and they just kind of take his body off. And the guy comes over and raises your hand in victory.
Adrastos does not lift his other hand this time.
All right. That's two victories. Congratulations.
Okay. I am going to take my short rest now because now I'm at half health.
Okay. Very good.
Okay. Short rest.
So they're all back in the red foyer at this time, taking their rest. The rest of the games finish on it. There's a few surrenders this time. Nobody else is carried off in the bloody mess that Adrastus is. Oh, poor Satyr.
Okay, I didn't roll my healing. Yeah. Hold on, I will do that real quick.
He just can't get no satisfaction.
I couldn't resist.
I couldn't resist. I've been holding on to that one since I picked the Satyr to be one of the contestants.
I will heal. So I only use one hit die, so I only heal three.
Okay. All right. I want to make sure, is anybody in the stadiums, anything particular you're doing at this point?
Only if Tycheros managed to get me one of those little spyglasses, in which case, or like the little magnifying ones, then in which case I will be starting to scan.
Are you actually going to go looking around to see if you can find one, Tycheros? Is that the plan?
Kind of. I don't mean to eavesdrop, but I am known for having a spyglass. You can just use mine. Yes. and she'll hand over the telescope that she has.
Oh, perfect. Thank you. And yes. I will. Okay. Yeah.
No, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, I'm just going to say I'm also going to use my second wind ability since I can do it per short rest. So I'll just second wind myself for a little bit of extra.
Very good.
I will spend most of the time using this because it's definitely not just a spyglass and it's like a telescope, right? Like, this is way too much.
Yeah.
For me. Yeah. Okay. So I'll just mostly focus on the other side of the Colosseum.
Okay. And what are you looking for? Anything in particular or just scanning?
That specific person.
Okay.
So I will look for the color black and then paleness of the skin and whatnot.
Okay. Give me a investigation and then, well, perception or investigation. I'll leave it up to you. Okay. Could be either one. Since you're inspecting this.
Yeah, no, this thing is, this thing gives me way too much telescopic abilities. That was a 7. I'm just like, right. Yep.
Yeah, you get several false starts as you see different things in black, but none of them turn out to be basically what you're looking for. All right, Adrastos, let's have a D20 and find out who your third competitor is.
Okay.
The field has been whittled down at this point.
16.
We're down to about 15 people. 16, all right. I should have put these in some kind of an order, but, you know, that would have made sense, right?
Adrastos just killed a guy. He's not having a good day.
Agrios is loving this. It's so much better than he thought it was going to be.
Can the way that these seedings and stuff are, is like Adrastos allowed to like come over and like talk to us?
He's back in the red room. He could have left it if he wanted to. Or Ariana is his trainer. You could go see him in the red room.
Oh, okay, cool. I'm gonna just pop down to check in on him because of what happened.
Okay.
He's kind of sitting, you know, he's got his hands on his knees and just like nose in his hands. It wasn't honorable. They shouldn't have brought him into the ring. I fought him like a fighter. I did him the honor of battle, but he wasn't ready.
You did what you were here to do. There is no dishonor in that. And you will take the next one. Victory is not always as clean as we wish it was.
You know how well I know that.
Continue to know it.
He just stands up, kind of just shakes off his mane. He has taken the gold band off and has washed it so that there's no blood on it. And then there's,
All right.
Well, she'll give him a big slap on the side of the shoulder and push him out to the front and then go back to the seating.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It, because of you're down to the number of players, and it's, you know, like 14 people in combat at this point, they're taking in two groups, one group going clockwise, one counterclockwise to the spaces, so that you don't see your opponent until you're actually in your ring. You won't know who it is. So being on the shorter route, Adrastos, you end up in the ring first, and then your opponent is escorted in. A female centaur. About the same height as Mira. A little bit similar looking. And she walks in and she's flexing and...
I'll offer my hand in the fight well, warrior.
And she will take it as well. And you too. I promise to try and not hurt you too bad. And smiles and laughs about it.
He smiles and laughs and says, I certainly hope not. You look very powerful indeed.
And I need you to roll initiative, please.
Four.
Okay, well, this time your opponent rolled better than you, so...
Okay.
But congratulations on that one. Okay. So the horn sounds... And she is going to kind of circle you a little bit and maneuver in, trying not necessarily to get around to the side of you, but just to see kind of how you react to it. And okay. She throws... Sorry, go ahead.
I'm reacting to it. So I'll just stay like... I'm very clearly like fighting like I'm still got a sword and shield. Like I'm keeping this part of my body kind of like curled in, and I'm keeping that turn towards her as I turn.
Okay. Looks like you hurt your arm in that first round, and she feints a punch like she's going for the arm that, you know, got Charlie horsed in the first round, but doesn't make contact and draws back.
He doesn't react.
Okay. You're up.
Okay. Just because I'm curious, was that a missed attack?
As far as you can tell, and from you, give me a perception.
For the sake of mechanics, can I riposte that?
No.
Okay.
So that answers that question, doesn't it?
Yes. Okay. All right. Gosh, she's triggering sad memories, so I'm not going to take it easy on her this time. I'm going to go ahead and faint.
Okay.
To give myself advantage, and I'm also going to kind of like move in and then come in with a jab. It's just going to be unarmed.
Okay.
Not using the claws this time. Wow. Even with advantage, I missed.
All right. So you come in to, you faint and you come in to throw your punch. And she takes that moment. She dips down her front leg and turns so that you're kind of beside her. And she is going to kick out with her back legs.
Okay.
And she's going to miss with both of those kicks.
Okay. Then she's going to get a riposte.
All right.
Okay. 10?
No, that is a miss.
Okay.
So you attempt to riposte and come in, and you're up.
Okay.
Because that was your bonus action, right?
That was my reaction.
Reaction, so, yeah. Pardon me. Yeah.
So yeah, I'll just go for an attack.
Okay.
Not fainting this time. I missed.
All right.
I spoke Frankenstein's praises too soon.
I need an athletics or acrobatics check from you, please.
Okay. 11.
19. She does the thing with her legs again, bends down and grabs you and just gets you in a bear hug with your arms pinned to your side. You are grappled.
Okay. I would like to attempt to break the grapple.
Okay. And she's going to stand up back to full height with you grappled. So, okay.
17.
14. You are able to break free.
Okay. Is that my action?
Yeah, that would be your action.
All right. Well, action surge.
Okay.
Fainting attack.
Okay.
Natural 20.
Very good.
Okay, so remind me how we're doing. Is it max plus roll?
Max plus roll. That is correct.
Oh, geez. Okay, so that is...
I'm getting ready to write down a lot of damage here. So
21 bludgeoning damage.
Oh, man.
So I'm just going to break out of the grapple, take both hands, and just hammer strike the top of her head.
All right. On the way down, I guess. So you go whack and then land on your feet. All right. You do this and it hits and just knocks her for a bit. And she is going to blindly flail out with her hooves at you. So I'm going to roll these attacks with disadvantage.
Okay.
And that is going to be a 17.
That will
hit. First one.
Yeah.
Hold on, I gotta grab some dye. My apologies. Okay. Oh my god. That is going to be 9 bludgeoning damage from one hoof.
Okay.
Be glad the other one didn't go because it was a nat 20. great. I rolled the same thing on both. That's gonna be a 12.
That'll still hit.
Which is still a hit. Okay. And that is going to be 5. Bludgeoning damage as the other hoof comes out and just blindly smacks into you.
All right.
And she is still a little out of and off kilter on it, so I'm going to give you advantage on this attack.
Great. So I'm going to spit out a little blood. I'm going to take my bonus action to second wind.
Okay.
Because she kicks the crap out of me. All right. So I will heal 6. And then because I have advantage, I'm just going in. But I will also use my natural weapons.
That is a hit.
Six slashing damage.
All right. With that, she backs up for a moment, and you can see she's thinking about it. And she raises a hand and holds up a finger.
I will offer the warrior handshake hand again.
And she will come in and she will shake your hand and good fight.
And I will lift her hand with mine. And then Stein, I will say, for Mira!
The crowd goes wild. Excellent. That is 3 victories.
Oh, yes.
I don't know if you can hear it, but my, I can't know if you hear it, but my neighbor in his homemade race car just did a victory lap around for you. So.
Yeah!
He does this every night, and I'm very tempted to take a pair of police tire treadles and just roll it across the road one night, but would I do that? Yes, I would.
Yeah.
Drastos, she's surrendering. Now's your chance, kill her!
Ha-ha!
All right, excellent, excellent. So, again, there's another break.
How many more rounds are there? Would I know?
This is going to be the last round.
Great. I'm going to use...
For tonight. So.
Okay, I'm going to use both of my hit die here.
Okay.
Because, oof.
Depending on how this goes, there will be a final round the next day, possibly. So we'll see how this ends up.
All right, and I'm back to full health.
Okay.
All right.
Anybody in the stands, I want to check and see. You're still panning and looking, and I will say that you're not having any luck seeing this person at this point. So.
It's also... Sorry, it's also getting pretty dark, right?
Yeah.
Is that what? Yep. Okay, so, yep. All right.
Are we sitting together?
That's what I thought you all were doing from what we said earlier.
Okay, that's what I figured. I'm just making sure. With his attention being drawn away from the fight, he actually might ask, what is it that you two are doing?
Well, Tycheros mentioned that. Remember the black cloaked figure that I was talking about? Tycheros might have caught a glimpse of them on the other side. So, you know, duties of the researcher and all.
Yeah. We're researching.
Should someone go wander over there and check?
You said they may be affiliated with Athreos, right? Due to what, the cloak?
That was the only thing that I would say. The only so because the procession also had those similar black cloaks, but all of them kept to themselves and were notably followers of Athreos.
Hmm. Well, I'd be happy to go and talk to them. I feel if they are a follower of Athreos, being approached by a fellow follower will be less troublesome.
Well, that's the thing. Tycheros saw them, but I didn't see any mention of them. I didn't see them at all.
Research mission! Let's go. Let's just go. But we'll miss Adrastos, but we've seen a lot. Research mission!
Well, we can still see from as we walk. I mean, we can pay attention.
Yeah.
Yes, I have no doubt that regardless of whether we're watching Adrastos or not, he's going to win anyways.
Who's going? Do you need muscle?
Seeing as how we're trying to...
I don't want to intimidate them. And that is typically what you do.
Yes, it is. Is that bad?
It's appropriate in certain situations, but in this scenario, I don't want to scare them off before we get whatever information we may be able to from them.
Exactly.
Sometimes I find intimidation gets a lot of information.
Perhaps we can have some kind of signal, a call sign, in case we get into trouble.
Okay.
What would be best? I mean, it's rather loud at the Coliseum, so maybe something more visual?
It would be hard for visual ones, since our magic is dampened in here as well.
I've got just the thing.
So this has never, I don't know if this has ever actually come up, but it is in his character art, and it is on this sheet. Rios reaches down and takes this, he has like a horn, like a minotaur horn, turned into a loud horn, and gives it to Vara.
Just blow this if you need me.
The Vivazula.
Ole, 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 ole. Ole, ole.
Vara looks at it like very like happy to have this. This is perfect. I haven't blown one of these in quite a long time.
Not magical, just loud as hell.
Oh, I know it.
Very useful.
Everybody around you kind of turns to look. You know?
Well, no one's blown it yet.
No, they heard you say that.
Oh, I see.
There's fear in the eyes of the people sitting around.
We'll make sure there's not that many people around. I'll just take a look around. I'll just say, not in anybody's ear at least, right?
I'll do that.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's go. I'll take you to the spot I saw.
Perfect.
All right, I'll follow suit.
Okay. So it's going to take you a little while to make your way around to the other side of the stadium. So, and the other two of you are staying put, right? Ariana and Agrios?
Yeah.
Right.
I might look. She's in character. She's not actually looking for anything, but Krista would like to potentially take a look at the people actually on the grounds and stuff. So like as Adrastos was fighting and sort of the people that are maybe cleaning up and things like that. Okay. She's just kind of watching for like opponents and then also like making sure that like, okay, did they clean up that? Did anyone put something in the sand? Did anyone, you know, did this one get dealt with properly? But she's kind of keeping an eye out if she sees anything weird on the field.
Okay. Well, it's generally good, clean fighting. Give me a perception check. Let's just... No biting has occurred.
No biting.
No magic.
Yep, good. Oh, that's a 22.
All right. So the remaining contestants are a Leonin, a Minotaur, a very, very well-constructed human.
Well-constructed. I like that.
And, of course, another Leonin with whom you're familiar.
Fantastic. Wonderful. All right. She's
Adrastos.
Watching them. She says she'll have watched a lot of their fights as well, and just like if she thinks there's anything that Adrastos might need to know, she'll go back. Like if any of them have been like favoring a side, but she'll probably just keep it to herself for now.
Okay. Very good. Adrastos, please roll me a d20.
Okay. 7.
Wow. All right.
I don't like this, Tam. You're making me real uncomfortable.
I'm sorry. I don't mean to. I picked out opponents throughout it, and I'm like, I wonder if he's going to get this one anywhere throughout it. And you did, and I'm thrilled. So
okay.
I'm quite happy.
Okay. Well, I like story things.
All right. So you once again they march everyone around, and so you can see the remaining opponents. You see the Minotaur. You do see another Leonin. And you see this. I'm just going to, for roughly, a gladiator is obviously someone who fights. This is their thing. They're tuned for this. And you are led to your circle. And the other Leonin is led in across from you.
Okay.
And when he steps in, he kind of, you know, roughs and postures a little bit. And real competition. I look forward to this.
What clan do you hail from?
Emberi. And you?
Sunclaw.
Sunclaw? I didn't know there were any Sunclaw left. I thought you all died crying out for help from Heliod.
Better to die in battle than to live in the cowardice of the gods, Emberi.
And he will high five you with that one. No offense meant, brother. No offense meant.
And clasp, you know, manly like flex from Predator. None taken.
So everybody watching, what they see is this. He's too ready.
Yeah.
All right. Roll initiative.
Five.
19.
All right.
All right.
I figured this would be the one, so here we go.
All right. So he's going to, the horn sounds and going to kind of be ready for a moment, and he's going to look at his hands and go, claws in or out.
Make your move, champion. I'll follow.
All right. First swing is going to come at you, and that is a dirty 20.
All right.
And claws are out.
Okay.
And that is going to be 6 slashing damage.
All right.
And is going to punch out again. And that is going to be 23.
All right.
And that is also going to be another 6 slashing damage.
Okay, I'm real glad I healed the full.
And he's going to he's going to back up a little bit. Come on.
So I will I'll kind of straighten up with the slashes and just spit blood on the floor. And then I'll come in with my claws out. I'm going to do a fainting attack.
Okay.
Thirteen.
That is a hit.
So that will be 9 slashing.
Okay.
And then I will go ahead and action search. And I'm going to give him another... Oh, wait, I can't give him another fainting attack because that's as a bonus action. So just a regular attack, then. Fourteen, that should hit.
Yep. That is a hit.
And that will be 7 slashing damage.
All right. So you get a couple of good hits on him like he got on you. Good, yeah! And he is immediately going to punch out at you.
Okay.
And he is going to punch, and it is just going to slide right by your face. But he's going to drop his arm and come in with his other...
Can I riposte
for absolutely, that miss? Absolutely.
Right. So riposte, here we go.
Oh, that wouldn't be then.
Okay. Because I want this to go through, I'm going to use my inspiration.
All right. Very good.
And it's even worse.
Okay. Okay.
All right.
So you try and punch back at him, and he's going to take advantage of that as you're a little bit off center and come around the side. And I mean, that's going to be like a 27. So jeez. I think he's hitting pretty good there.
Yeah.
And that is going to be 6 slashing damage.
Okay. Man, he hits hard.
He's going he's going to take and fling the blood off of his claws a little bit. And some of it dangles. So he's going to kind of brush it off and go, come on, hit me hard.
All right. Fainting attack.
All right.
That hits pretty hard. 23.
All right. Pegged him.
Ooh. 12 slashing damage.
Wow, that is pretty good. Okay. So you get a good hit on him with that one and cut across, and he kind of backs up and he takes and, you know, kind of wipes some of the blood from the cut above his eye out, and he's now, you know, blinking with one eye as he's got blood flowing into it, and he's like, all right, yeah, good hit, Sunclaw, good hit.
Bring your finest, Ember Eye.
And he is going to roar and charge at you. And that is a 12.
That'll hit.
All right. And that is going to be 6 slashing damage. Okay. As he charges forward with his claws out and just catches you in the chest and pushes on you. And he's going to use the force to push you back not the force, but the force of the hit. To push you back. Just want to be clear, there's no magic in use here. He's going to push you back a few feet and then take a step back and kind of shake it off and come on. And you're up.
All right. My last fainting attack. A bunch. Twelve more damage.
You hit him, and you can see as his head kind of whips the wrong way, and he falls down and goes to one knee, and has his other hand on the ground, and he stops and breathes for a moment, and I believe in the fight, but you've bested me, and he's going to raise a finger.
You fought well, Imberai. You did glory to your clan. Sun Claw!
He's going to stand up and ram into you and just pick you up in this, like, bear hug.
Yeah, and I'll just, like, drum on the top of his head.
He starts headbutting you.
We're just fully broing out. Oh, I would like chat to know. That is how much health I have left.
He has one. One.
Ariana's so jumping up and down, like slapping Agrios.
Oh, what? It was going so well.
And he's going to stop and put both hands on your shoulders and look you in the eye and... Friend, Baragon of the Imberai, I look forward to seeing you again.
Adrastos of the Sunclaw. Same, my friend.
He pats you on the shoulder. Good victory.
You do a Rescos glory.
In the other...
Ooh, chicken shit!
Oh, Lord. In the other match between the gladiator and the minotaur, they carry the body of the gladiator away as the minotaur stamps his feet. Hormogus! And he hits his chest and points at you.
And I'll point right back.
All right.
Kill Adrastos! Yeah!
And I probably look really... Like, there's blood coming out of my mouth looking at him.
And the crowd wonders, was he saying kill Adrastos or kill Adrastos? Not sure where the comma goes.
The world may never know.
I was about to say...
Important commas.
Why not both?
Very important commas.
I think either way, Agrius will be happy.
True.
All right. For the party members who decided to go searching around the other side of the stadium, whoever has the highest modifier for investigation can roll with advantage.
I only have a 3.
I have a minus 1.
Yeah, you're it.
Okay. All right.
I'm a researcher.
Advantage it is.
That means you search and then you search again. You're a researcher because
researcher.
That's okay, Tycheros. I'm stealthy.
That is a 15.
All right. You look around the area where Tycheros points out where you believe this person was standing. And you're kind of eyeing around a little bit. And then you notice that just where this alleyway, this staircase, enters into the stadium, there's a small hole in the wall. It looks like it's been there for a while. It's just some kind of a crack or something. You know, this happens. Stadiums, marble, things happen. And you go up and investigate this. And inside, you find this spherical object that is the darkest shade of black that you have ever seen.
Could I make some sort of a roll to see if I know what this is? Is it like, can I pick it up? Is it?
You can do whatever you want to do. It is about the size of a golf ball.
Okay, so like I'll try to kind of like grasp it and feel like the texture of it and whatnot. Okay. And
so you reach in, pull it out of this hole, and you hold it in your hand, and you suddenly hear this high-pitched whine noise, and you see a fingerprint begin to appear on the shape of the ball.
I drop it immediately.
Okay.
And just book it the other way, grab like kind of like both hands grabbing Vara and Tycheros, just as much as I can. I'll just kind of like push them away. It's just, we gotta get out of here right now and run.
Okay. Yes.
What?
Okay. What is it? Something that just concerns us or concerns everybody?
Let's just keep going. I don't know.
I need a dexterity save from all three of you.
Oh no.
Oh no.
Oh no. Wait. 16.
Okay. Vara?
10.
Did you say 10?
On the deck save, yes.
Okay. As you are running out, Ptolemaeus, you've got them. You're a little ahead of them as you're trying to drag them along. And then you hear the sound. You feel this blast of heat. And you hear the sound as the world behind you explodes in this ball of fire. And Ptolemaeus, you are thrown forward into the dirt. And when this happens, you lose grip on the hands of Vara and Tycheros. And you hear the noise of crumbling stone behind you. Tycheros and Vara, you are going to take 6 fire damage and 10 bludgeoning damage as stones from the back of the stadium fall on you.
Wow.
And pin you to the ground.
Oof.
Meanwhile, there is screaming from behind as Agrios and Ariana, you can see across, and you just see as the far side of the stadium around the stairwell lights up in this bright orange light. And when that dims, you see people who are still mobile engulfed in flames, and you see the collapsed bodies of others. And you see that a large section of the stadium is missing.
Agrios immediately starts charging across the stadium toward the site of the explosion.
Ariana's right next to him.
Honestly, Adrastos would be too. If he saw people in danger, he'd be like, oh, deal with you later, bull boy.
Yep.
Well, I was putting you back towards the red room, but I'm going to say you didn't make it all the way back through that entrance. So this kind of happened behind you, a little ways away, off to your left. So, Agrios and Ariana, I'm going to need a dexterity check from both of you as you are attempting to clear this retaining wall and drop the 20 feet down to the ground.
Okay. Dexterity check or dexterity saving throw?
You can do acrobatics as well if you want to.
What? How's athletics?
You know what? I'll go with athletics too, because dadgummit.
Nice. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
I'll get to you in just a moment, Ptolemaeus.
Okay. If it's athletics, I feel a lot better about that. It's a 16.
Okay, that's good.
I have plus zero to my dex.
Athletics is good. I should have said athletics or acrobatics. So. Oh, wow. All right.
So it's all okay.
So the two of you make it over this wall, Agrios leaping through the air and just hitting the ground and you know, rolling into it. Ariana, however you make it over this and get down to the ground beautifully. Yep. And you are running your way across this field. While many people are running it away, you two are charging towards it. Ptolemaeus, you had a question?
Oh, yeah. Quick question. How much damage did I take from the explosion? And did I fall in like the 20 feet of
you,
height?
You were outside of it. You saved. So you were past where everything fell down. So you were protected from the worst of it.
Okay. So you
would have felt the blast. You maybe have ringing ears. You're a little disoriented, but you're not going to take damage from it.
Okay.
I'm not going to go any further than that. You'll have to investigate if you want to know more. Adrastos, you said you were turning and running towards us as well. For you, it would be a straight shot. You're on the stadium ground. Uh-huh. But as you head that way, you see Agrios and Ariana do this magic act of coming over the wall, hitting the ground, and taking off the same direction that you're headed. So, fortunately, when the three of you get to the other side, you don't have to climb the wall here because it no longer exists.
Once I get my bearings, immediately I'll turn around and see all the rock and I'll just start clearing it out like fuck.
And so when I get there, I'll say, Ptolemaeus, is someone in there?
Yes, Vara, Tycheros.
Help me. I want to be clear. Adrastos, Ariana, and Agrios, you are on the inside of the stadium. Ptolemaeus is on the outside.
Jesus, okay.
Okay.
So you wouldn't be able to see him directly.
To us.
Well, I'm still going to start throwing rocks.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ptolemaeus, Tycheros, and Vara were on this side somewhere. We need to find them.
Yep. No, not wasting time, just hucking rocks.
And I will say that the flames are still going here. So as you dig closer, things fall down in your area that are just flaming. So if you continue to proceed to go through the flames, I am going to need dexterity saves from you.
Okay. I mean, Adrastos is not thinking about himself right now.
Okay. Ptolemaeus, you said you were going to be digging from the outside, kind of trying to dig in as well. Are you just removing stones, or are you particularly looking for Vara and Tycheros?
I'm particularly looking for Vara and Tycheros and the horn as three things that I'm looking for. If I could find the horn, I wanna blow on the horn as soon as possible. But Vara and Tycheros come first.
All right, go ahead and give me a perception as you're digging. Then.
Okay.
All right. So Adrastos, how did you do?
14.
All right, Ariana.
6.
Oh my. Okay.
Yeah.
Agrios.
Can I also get in there? Let's see. I'm also getting there, then that's a 9.
All right.
We're great at this. It said magic still feels dampened in here, right?
Can you detect that? I would say, yeah, you could detect it. So yes, magic is still dampened.
Well, I mean, she's going to try and use lay on hands, which I guess counts as magic for these purposes. Okay. She'll try it and it'll fail.
It'll fail. You are going, those of you who failed your dex save on this, you are going to take 6 fire damage. And you are going to notice that as you try and pull back from it, the flames stick to you. And as you try to brush it away, whatever this material is that is causing the fire continues on you. You're going to have to do something or you're going to get more burns.
Was a 14 enough?
A 14 was enough.
Okay.
You're able to get through and not get this stuff on you, but you suddenly notice Ariana and Agrios have fire on them, and as they try to brush it off, the fire goes to their next hand. Or paw, or hoof, or whatever they're using, so.
Okay. I honestly don't know what he would do at this point, because he's like, they're tough, they can handle it, and he's going to keep going.
All right.
Could I have felt that, since I'm technically outside, could I have felt that the magic is back to for me, because there's no dampening on the outside of the...
On the outside of the stadium. That's correct. You would feel that you have your magical abilities.
I immediately want to... I immediately want to, instead of finding the horn, use prestidigitation to make a horn sound and see if there is any bit of a... if it's loud enough for anybody to hear on the other side.
It's thaumaturgy, so you could make it as loud as you want, so...
Yeah, I will try to imitate that horn sound.
Okay. And Agrius, I think you've actually blown it before, so we would actually know what the sound is. I think you did that in one of the other your sessions.
I guess I might have.
Yeah, I think I seem to recall that you did for something. I can't remember what it was.
It was either the harpies or the goblins or something like
that. Yeah, I think it was with the harpies, yeah. So, okay. So, Agrios, you hear the sound of your horn. Or a reasonable approximation.
Coming from outside,
yeah.
Agrius thinks that's very interesting. Also, he's on fire. Now, Sam has a pretty good idea that this probably isn't going to work, but Agrios is going to try and reach for his water skin and see if he can douse the fire with water.
Okay. And it does not work. The fire does not stop.
Yeah, I have a feeling I know basically what this is. I do not, however, know what to do about it. especially with that magic.
I think this is going to be a good place to stop for this evening.
Oh, no!
Oh, no way!